See, the encounter with God is absolutely essential. Being discipled and taught of the Holy Ghost is absolutely essential. Growing and maturing in the Word of God is absolutely essential. And if you don't have those things happening in your life, you're not going to move forward in what Father has for us. And I believe that the more that we begin to recognize what God says in His Word, for example, that we come into the holies of holies, that we His temple, that all the fullness of His glory dwells in the midst of the church, and we begin not to pretend, but to engage in that reality, to accept that as a reality, all the reverence that takes over our lives. And in that midst of that reverence, in the midst of that expectation, Father is allowed to do more. He enlarges our hearts to receive more. If you think that the church is functioning today on the planet Earth in the dimensions of that which God purchased for us through the Holy Ghost, through Christ Jesus' blood and poured out the Holy Ghost for us to have, I tell you, you're mistaken. But you know what? There can be those people who hearken to the voice of the Lord, because in every generation, Father raises up people, voices, to call folks His people out of the place that they've been living over into a realm of glory that He's already made us completely capable of functioning in, that He's already fully provided for us to have. But you know what? You know what happens? God demands a lot of change. All of our expectations change. I mean, I'm telling you right now, the glorious church has been held in prison too long through popular opinion. Through just little splashes of the move of God, and people get stuck in the splash instead of jumping into the move. Instead of going into the deeper realms of His presence and of His glory. But this is what we've here. This is what Father brought us into this world to do. Father brought us in this world and anointed us at this moment in time to call His people into a greater realm of yieldedness. I love the encounter that Isaiah had that is not recorded. An encounter that obviously was revealed through the things he had to declare as God, the Holy Ghost, put His voice on the inside of him. And you read Isaiah 1 and 2 and 3 and 4 and 5. Then all of a sudden Isaiah came to a whole other encounter. And he spoke some bold words on behalf of God in Isaiah chapter 1 through 5. But after the encounter of Isaiah chapter 6, he goes to a whole other dimension of speaking on behalf of Father. And in that encounter, he says, Lord, I'm unclean. Lord, before I could stand before you and speak on your behalf, but now I see you in a way that I did not even know existed. He saw him high and lifted up, and his glorious train filled the temple. And the Lord immediately takes care of the problems. He takes care of the bad conscience. He takes care of the guilt. He takes care of the condemnation and the shame, and provided at that moment in time a seraphim to fly with coals from off the altar to touch the lips of the prophet, to take his uncleanness away from him and his reproach away from him, that he might speak on his behalf. And with that touch came also an emboldening power where he was able to stand up and say, I will go for you. I'll go on your behalf. Father said, who can go for us? All heaven is hushed. It's silent. Who can speak on God's behalf? All heaven is silent. Father's asking, who can go? Who will go for me? Who will stand in my place in my stead, be my ambassador, and speak on my behalf? All heaven and earth is silent. Isaiah, suddenly cleansed and washed and purified just by the coal from off the altar. I mean, the blood touches the coal, you see. The seraphim's not hurt by fire, but it's too holy for him to even touch. He can't even touch the coals. Listen to me. How much more by the blood of Jesus Christ today? How much more should you begin? Listen, you're going to have to let God take you and move you out of the realms that you've been living into, the realms that His Word calls us up to. Until we connect with faith in that realm of faith that His Word describes, we never get to enter in. You got as much as you've been willing to connect with. Right now, you've got as much right now from the Holy Spirit, from the supply of heaven, as you've been willing to connect with and believe in God's Word. That's it. All the rest of the realms and the glory and the dominion of Christ Jesus is there waiting for you and is just as available. But you're going to have to believe the Word of God and begin to call it so, begin to view it and begin to live it and begin to say it's yours, even though you may have all kinds of harassing thoughts. just a few minutes, moments ago, I saw in the spirit someone, I don't know if they're here, the Lord didn't choose to reveal to me whether they were here or watching by web, but you've recently had a blood sample taken, and you received a bad report of a disease. I'm going to tell you right now, Jesus Christ the healer is right here living on the inside of me, speaking through me to you right now, the same living God that has brought this wonderful, glorious salvation, that created all things, that created you, is your healer right now. I believe somebody watching, it's actually someone watching on the web right now. It might even be YouTube, because Father can see out into the future too. Hallelujah. He gets people raised. Somebody said, how could God speak to me through a program that was 10 years ago recorded? He's amazing. Somebody say, how can God do this? He's amazing. How can God do that? He is amazing. How could God be eternal? He's amazing. How could God create all the endless universe? He's a miracle-working God. He's just amazing. Father sees where you're at. He knows what's going on in your life, and he's looking at you going, come on, give yourself a break. Obey me. People begging God for things. Wait a minute. What do you mean begging God for things? He's begging you. And the only way you're ever going to be able to move forward with God is you're going to have an encounter with him. And then in that encounter, you're going to have to receive the supply of the Spirit, and it's a provision that he has made for us to be able to stand before him without fault, faultless, purified, with no condemnation, one with him, gloriously one with him. In that provision, Father will give you a boldness, he'll give you an anointing, so that now you can go on and be taught of God. People are saying that the encounter is all that they need. No, the encounter was so that you could get hooked up. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Father wants to supply all that you have need of. He will supply the increase, but you must connect. Say, God will supply the increase, but I must connect. Hallelujah. I want you to be seated. We welcome all of you here this morning. Listen, we just want you to understand where we're at. You got to understand where I'm at. I'm telling you right now, I'm in a different place than most people are. I'm not interested in the announcements. I'm not interested in the offering. I'm not interested in all the other things. I'm interested in God having his way and that which is described in the Word becoming a reality in our lives. I'm not interested in the problems, your problems, my problems, or anyone else's problems. I'm interested in Father's supply. I'm not interested in all my ideas, your ideas, or anyone else's ideas. I'm interested in the concepts that Father is trying to convey to us by his Spirit. You can't walk out on God and be right. People all the time say, I want the word of the Lord to come unto me. But then the word of the Lord comes unto them and they're offended. You hear me? He went, let's what you want to do is you want to recognize that God has given us an opportunity that goes beyond those opportunities that can be provided for us within the framework of academics and the framework of the government that we have in the United States of America, the jobs, the vocations, the opportunities that men can provide. God has provided something far greater for us, but I'm going to tell you right now, it's going to require a whole lot more commitment. It's going to require that you step out of that which you see and stop looking on those things which are seen and start looking on those things which are unseen. Stop having your response and your desire towards what you can, you know, taste and see and hear and handle and those things that you can comprehend. Come under the rulership of the Lord Jesus Christ. People walking out on the minister of the gospel. Somebody told me the other night, people coming to the meeting and walking out, spending the whole night outside while the woman of God was preaching. You don't belong here. You belong somewhere else. I'm going to tell you right now, because I understand this, and I tell this to people all the time, because Father is not going to do what he's going to do when there's a bunch of wet wood, when there's living among. Huh? When there's leaven among those that are supposed to be a lump that is unleavened. People want to demand it their own way. God's not called you and I to come and bring our opinion in this. He's called you and I to come and yield to that which he desires to show us and reveal to us of life, his abundant life. I want you to think about this. I want you to just consider the fact that he's poured out of his Spirit upon us so abundantly that out of our innermost beings flows supposed to flow the expressions of his divine glory like rivers. the issues of God should be so unlimited, so glorious, so continuous, that it's like rivers. I mean, the manifestation of the Spirit that is given to us in the word of wisdom and the word of knowledge and the discerning of spirits and the working of miracles and the gifts of healing and the gift of faith and prophecy and tongues and interpretation of tongues, the spirit of wisdom and revelation, the working the power of the Holy Ghost with mighty signs and wonders and demonstration of his divine glory should be something that we want more than anything else. And you're going to have to be willing to be taught of God. Quit walking out on God, because you're going to walk out one too many times. And then the enemy is going to be given right to deceive you. You're not going to walk back in. People are offended all the time because of the word of the Lord. The word of the Lord comes and they don't like what God, the change that God demands. You're no different than what you are because you've not been willing. You're not as like him as he wants you to be because you're not willing to make the adjustments that he demands. That's it. You're stuck in a human realm. I mean, if there's anything I want to get out of is a human realm and this self-consciousness. I was telling the Lord today, I'm saying, Father, please do whatever it takes. Help me to understand how to move out of the realm of my own understanding about myself, that you may more fully reveal yourself through me. The Lord's got all that you need. He wants to supply all that you have, that he has to you. But you've got to connect. I want you to open your Bibles with me, and I'm going to talk to you quickly. Maybe not so quickly, about what Father demands above all other things. When we talk about all these things that Father has done, when he poured out his Spirit, when he poured out the Holy Ghost in such a way that he came with all of his fullness to baptize us, to be with us and in us, when he poured out his glory upon us so that all that he has would become ours, it was... That everything in the realms of heaven, that authority and dominion over all the natural and physical realm, like walking on the water and commanding a few loaves and few fishes to be multiplied to feed the multitudes. All of those things ultimately have one purpose and one result, the miracle of you and I being made a new creation, being made one with him, being filled with his glory, made his temple. Where he lives and abides and walks in us and speaks through our mouths. All for one purpose, all for one end, all one ultimate thing that God demands. That we walk in the same kind of love that he showed us when he put our sins on the tree. That we walk in the same kind of love and submission and surrender. Come on now. You think about this. You think about this. I'm just going to really emphasize to you John 13:34, the words of the Lord Jesus, when he said, this is the commandment, that is just like I've loved you, that you love each other. This is how all men will know you are my disciples. And he's not just talking about just any kind of love. He's talking about the Jesus kind of love, the divine kind of love, the miracle kind of love, the love that flows by the Holy Ghost. You've got to have the Spirit of living God living on the inside of you. You've got to be yielded to him. You've got to be willing to cooperate with him. You've got to be willing to just obey those simple things that he's told us to obey. Otherwise, his glory is not going to be made manifest as he desires. Hallelujah. You know, I always have to obey the Holy Ghost and enjoy doing it. And I've discovered a long time ago that people got to be corrected so they can repent before they're ever going to receive the word. You got to be corrected so that you repent before you're ever going to be able to receive the supply of the Holy Ghost that Father's purpose to come unto you. Father wants to do something now for you right now that you've never had happen in your life. And if you're sitting in here in doubt and unbelief, there's no way God can do it. If you're not looking to him, the head who would supply, if you're not hungering and thirsting and calling after the one who has redeemed you by his blood, there is no way that there is going to be a response on the inside of you to that which God should so desires to supply. Listen to me. Listen to me. All you have to do is when Papa begins to make corrections in your life to say, yes, Lord, forgive me. I yield myself to you. Lord, I don't want to continue on the same. I want to grow. I want to mature. I want to have an increase. God's supplying something. God is supplying something. But unless we receive that which he supplies, we'll never grow. We'll never increase. So I want you to look at this verse of scripture with me. I want to try to make it very, very simple to you. Understand. Hallelujah. I got so many verses of scripture running through my heart, spirit right now.
It's going to take me a while to get to them. I'm going to just try to slow down and not just quote them all, see if I can get people to turn in the verses of Scripture. Maybe if you hear it and read it more, you just say, look, I know what God wants to do. You know what wisdom is? Wisdom is knowing what God wants to do and do it with him. You want to know what wisdom is? You want to know what wisdom is? Wisdom is knowing what God wants you to do and do it with him. You know where wisdom came from? His word. Hallelujah. The Bible. Everybody's got one. And then the Lord gives special anointings to those that he appoints and he sends so that people can hear the word and understand the word more perfectly. So how can they hear unless there be a preacher? And how can there be a preacher unless he be sent? I'm going to tell you right now, I'm sent. The Spirit of the Lord is upon me. He's anointed me with the Holy Ghost. Hallelujah. To proclaim the good news. The good news is that you can be one with God, step into all of his fullness, and operate out of the realms of heaven and no longer be confined to the realms of earth. The good news is that those who are broken heart, this moment in time, you can be healed of whatever brokenness and offense and problems and unforgiveness and bitterness and hurt that you may have, so that now you can begin to cooperate more freely with the Father. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. You can begin to receive those things that he has rather than living in a prison of offense and unforgiveness. He's given us the ability to proclaim liberty to the captives, to open up the prison doors to them that are bound, and to proclaim the acceptable year of the Lord. And I'm telling you, this is right now the time, the days of the great movings of God. I know on the outside it looks like darkness is over the land, gross darkness over the people, but get ready, because the shining brightness of God's divine glory is getting ready to rise like the rising of the sun at noonday. Hallelujah. It's like you're going to skip the whole morning period. It's just going to go right from the horizon, poof, right to midday, sun shining, bright, glorious. Hallelujah. Mighty God. Radiance of the presence of the living God. Now, this is, I know what I'm laboring for. People say, well, why don't you make these adjustments? More people come, make these other adjustments, then some more people come, then do these other compromises, then you get more. I'm not interested in all of that more. I'm not interested in that kind of increase. I'm not interested in that kind of growth. I'm interested in having what the Word of God describes very plainly. I'm not just interested in just a little bit of an overflow. I'm not just interested in one or two expressions of divine glory when God has provided for us all of his fullness. But to have all of his fullness, you've got to stop with all your stuff. To have all of his likeness and to have all of his glory, you're going to have to quit being so high on yourself, so infatuated with who you are, that you hold on to your opinions and your ideas and the things that you think you know about yourself and God, and begin to humble yourself under the mighty hand. That means under his mighty presence. Begin to conform to his image. Begin to come to a place in your life where God's word and what he describes for you is more important than what you've decided that you wanted to do with your life. Suddenly a transition comes and you want to do the will of the Father instead of your own will. This is a huge transition. I mean, so many people pray the prayer, thy will be done in this earth as it is in heaven. But they need to be the first one in line for his will to be done. Amen. Everybody's waiting for a revival to break out somewhere. God wants to begin with you. Somebody says, what must we do to have a move of God? I'm going to tell you. Go into a room all alone. Shut the door behind you. Draw a big circle on the floor. Get in the middle of the circle and say, God, send revival in the midst of the circle. Hallelujah. Ha, ha, ha. So Danaya. Things will begin to change. You get whatever we got to do to try to express to you your hunger, your thirsting, your yieldedness. What is hunger? Hunger is just simply this: looking at what God wants us to be, then saying, I want that. That's hunger. What is thirsting? Thirsting is looking at all that God would supply to us, all the increase of and all the glory that he has purposed and he's predestinated us to have, and say, God, I got to have that. And you got to have it, and you want it more than the stuff that you like about yourself and that you've chosen to do and that you've formed habits to do. You've formed routines around your own interests on a daily basis. People don't like to hear this, but everybody's getting ready to hear it. Because Papa just told us about 6 months ago that we're going. And then all of a sudden, doors right, left, and center begin to open up in some of the major churches of the United States of America. Father knows what he's doing, because I guarantee you, I mean, I'm always like thinking, honestly, when people invite me to come, I'm like, Do you know what you're getting yourself into? I don't think I'm going to be an asset. I believe I'm going to be a liability. I believe that when I step in and I begin to tell you what God's placed on the side of me to declare, that all of a sudden there's going to be some new reflections. There's going to be some new things that people have to deal with, and they become very challenging. And today I want to challenge you. I want you to begin to hear what the Word of God says and decide today whether you're going to obey it or whether you're going to prolong. Who are you going to put off? Because I'm telling you right now, you think, you know, the people that went to the nightclub the other night in Paris, just out partying, they didn't realize that suddenly disaster was going to come upon them, and they would find themselves standing before the living God, and He was going to evaluate their spirit, their soul, and their body, and they were going to give an account for everything that they did in their body. People don't realize that they sit in churches like somehow, you know, all these things are just optional, and it's not really that serious, and they can get around to it maybe someday, and that's called lukewarmness, because there's not a passion. There's not a urgency. When you have urgency, you've got a fire. When you have urgency, you don't run the risk of being lukewarm. There's an urgency to obey God. There's an urgency to do what He's commanded. There's an urgency to follow after Him. There's an urgency to respond to Him. Because at any moment, at any time, we're about to step into His presence and give an account for our souls. And it's not some kind of little, you know, arbitrary moment, a subjective moment where, you know, you've been just as good as everybody else, or you find yourself, most people find themselves better than everybody else. Father's not going to ultimately look at you and compare you among everybody else. He's not going to grade you on a bell curve. He's simply given to us the privilege of stepping into the life of Christ Jesus, His only begotten Son. He's going to judge every one of us and examine every one of us based upon those things which He has spoken. That's what Jesus said. He said, "My word will judge you or examine you in that day." There's nothing that escapes Father. Huh? There's nothing that escapes Father. The things, our responses describe a lot about our love for Him and our commitment to Him. And reality of it is, the Lord tells us that because the way that we responded to Him and allowed the anointing of the Holy Spirit to begin to express His love through us, we know that we have passed from death unto life, because we have the same kind of love for each other that God has for us. Just imagine if the Lord was going to measure out to you from His love the way that you measure out to everyone else. You listening to me? Yeah. Suddenly, or the way you've been treating those people that are around you, especially those who are your leaders, those who have been placed by God, and you've been so blessed to be placed in a position where somebody's received from heaven those things that need to be declared to you so the adjustments can be made in your life so you can step into a greater moving and outpouring of His glory and presence to your life. And suddenly those people are really receiving far less than love. They're receiving actually expressions of hate, because really, in reality, when we begin to define love in the terms of how God's defined love, He's described it on the basis of who He is and what He's done for us and the expression of His love. So all of a sudden, the way I've been loving you, Father says to me, I'm going to love you the same way you've been loving those that are around you. I pray that every person begin to understand that Father does measure out to each individual according to the way that they give it, the way that you are willing to operate in the things of the spirits, the way it's going to come back to you. The Lord's going to forgive you the way you forgive. He's going to show mercy the way you show mercy. He's going to show love the way that you show love. Those are the messages of Jesus. I want you to look quickly with me here in Ephesians chapter 4. And the Lord says this. He says, verse 15, He says, speaking the truth in love, you may grow up into Him. Speaking out the truth in love, you may grow up into Him, into every dimension of His fullness, into all things that He has. And you know, when you look at verse 15 in view of the fact that Paul has just laid out for us why he gave apostles, prophets, evangelists, pastors, and teachers, why he gave special ministry gifts, why he gave special anointings and placed them in the midst of His church. When you begin to understand that the church, this that we are right now, that which God ordained and brought into being when He baptized on that day of Pentecost,
that approximately 120 people with the Holy Ghost and fire. It was for the purpose of expressing all of his fullness. Ephesians chapter 1, verse 23, I want you to understand what God demands of thee. I want you to understand what God demands of you and the changes you're going to have to make and the attitude adjustments you're going to have to make and the behavior adjustments you're going to have to make. Ephesians 1:23 says his church is the fullness of him. Now, the Lord says to us, he says, I want you to begin to speak the truth in love that you may grow up into him, into all things, into Christ Jesus, who is the head. Out of the head, everything that the body needs is supplied. The body grows because of that which the head provides. And understand that he's talking and saying these things by the Holy Ghost in view of what he just described in the previous verses of Scripture. When he said, I've given apostles and prophets and evangelists and pastors and teachers so that you may be perfected, so that you may be built up, so that you may function in the work of the ministry, so that you may grow. Listen to the growth. Listen to the increase that God wants you to have. You can't have increase till you connect. Say, I can't have increase until I connect. And the way that I connect is the way that I'm going to have increase. Have you ever seen a person with a withered arm? A person whose arm became disconnected neurologically. It became disconnected muscularly. It became disconnected because it wasn't receiving the supply that the head gives. And the other arm is three times longer than the withered arm. It never grew. It never developed. It became full of atrophy and shrunk and shriveled. It never connected. It was there. It was a part of the body, but it never could do anything. It was made, designed to be able to do all of these things, but it wasn't connected properly. It had some part connection, but it wasn't fully connected. It wasn't compacted. It wasn't joined together in the proper way. Thus, the supply that comes, the results in the growth and the increase could never be realized. Listen to me. I'm talking to you because God demands change. He demands attitude change. He demands the way that you approach him. So many people just come to the meeting and just act like, you know, just some kind of religious ideology, some religious function. They're self-conscious. They're overwhelmed with who they are. They don't know how to love people. They don't know how to interact with people. They don't know how to humble themselves. They don't know how to give the hug, so to speak. They got so many things going on inside of their thinking, so many offenses, so much unforgiveness, so much of the other stuff that should not even have a place within the life of those who've been baptized in the Holy Ghost and fire, filled with the glory of heaven, where the expressions of God are flowing out of them like the effulgencies of divine glory, like rivers, inexpressible, inexhaustible dimensions of God's divine abundance, of his abundant life. See, I want something that the Word of God describes. I don't believe is esoteric or positional. I believe it's a living reality that God has created us to have and to function in. And we've not been willing to do what he says to do. And so the increase that he wants to have, that he wants to give us, we've not been willing to receive because we've not been properly connected. Paul gives two programs of growth immediately following those verses of Scripture that I just quoted to you there in 11 and 12. In verse 13, he says, that we may come into the fullness of the measure of the maturity. He uses this word. He says, there's a measure for you. He says it down in verse 16. I'm going to get to it in a minute. He's talking about the supply that he wants to give to us so that we come into the full increase of all that he himself is, so that we may grow up into him. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Colossians 2:19, you can just hold this up for just a minute because I'm not half done with Ephesians. But Colossians 2:19 expresses very strongly what I just said. From the head, I know, and I'm going to make it in a very positive way because Paul had to use it by a negative application, but the head supplies the whole joints and bands, every part of the body of Christ, and God's not talking in this dimension about us individually. He's talking to us about us collectively, how we interact with each other, now how we're connected one with another. If you say that you love God and don't love your brother like I love you, then you don't know him. We know that we pass from death into life because we love the brethren like Father has loved us, like Father has loved me. You have that same kind of love. Now you're connected properly. Now the supply of heaven can flow to you because somehow you've made a connection. You responded to God the Holy Ghost in the encounter, and now your heart is captivated by his presence.
And in being captivated by his presence, you're receiving that which the head, whom you're looking unto, the author and finisher of your faith, Jesus Christ, is supplying. And I'm not just throwing a bunch of words at you. I'm throwing a bunch of scripture at you so I can somehow try to convince you to quit acting like you've been acting, living like you've been living out of the realm of your own spirit. Because even though you've been given a new spirit, you can still live out of the realm of your own spirit. You've been given a new spirit so that you can submit yourself to the Holy Spirit.
Hallelujah.
And be taught of God. And Father is so patient and loving and so merciful and so long-suffering. He's willing to deal with us, even though we're on most of God's people are on a slow growth program. It's time to get on the fast track. It's time to start saying, okay, Lord, I'm going to start doing it and living it and being what you described in your word. I'm going to start living it like you just described for me to live it. I'm going to start doing it like you described for me to do it. Hallelujah. That means you don't ever talk bad about anybody anywhere. You don't ever have an opinion about people always making opinions about people. They have partial information. There's always more than two sides to every story. There's your side, the other person's side, and God's side. Hallelujah. Everybody want to talk about, well, there's two sides. Well, there's at least three. And I can say there's four, the onlookers too. And the people that were party to the information. And so somebody wants to make a judgment, you better first consult with God and say, what's your opinion about what happened? What's your opinion about that person? What's your opinion about what was said and what was done? You're listening to me. Father has supplied. He's from the head. There is a supply. There's a supply coming. So every bit of growth and every bit of increase that we have, and I'm not talking about numbers. I'm talking about this relationship. I'm talking about all this divine power and glory that has been made available to us so that we have functioned as a church and we have functioned individually first and as a church secondly, and all the fullness of the divine goodness of Almighty God expressed in Christ Jesus. Just think about this. So you look at Colossians 2:19, the head supplies that which every joint and band needs, huh? So that it can increase, so that you may increase with the increase, hallelujah, of God. So that you may grow as you're growing in God. You hear me? You may grow. What kind of, every kind of growth, you name it. I wish that above all things you prosper and be in health, even as your soul prospers. Listen to me. Every kind of, people get stuck on the financial side. I know people have really eroded this wonderful riches of heaven down to a place of monetizing it. Forget about the money, man. Forget about the clothes. Forget about the food. It's really very little importance. Huh? Your body is far more than raiment, and your life far more than meat. Huh? God's got all heaven available for you, but you're gonna have to come to this. Are you ready? Yeah. I'm gonna hurt you bad right now. You gotta change. Amen. You gotta be radically different than you are right now. Amen. And the good news is that you're not on your own. God the Father, God the Son, and God the Holy Ghost is all working passionately and desperately to make these things happen. But we've got to quit ignoring him. And fundamentally, we ignore him in his word. We ignore him over and over again where the Holy Ghost has come to lead us and to guide us in all truth. He's with us and in us. He's supplying all these wonderful things. People get, as it were, captivated by the outworking rather than the inworking. They become captivated by the things, by the that which they can observe, rather than being captivated by the person who's still in the realms of the unseen. I know he's here. I know he's here first and foremost because his word said he's here, so it's a done deal. I know all the fullness of his glory is here because that's what he said. It's a done deal. I know that when I say he's here, the Holy Ghost is here, Christ Jesus is here, Father's here in our midst right now. And then all of a sudden, I have also this wonderful ability to where that I have, by his wonderful supply, the ability to sense his presence, to be responsive to his joy, to his peace, to his glory, to the working of his divine power. And it just continues to get bigger and bigger from there. How much of all these things that God would give you do you really
really desire? And how much of the things are your heart set upon the things that you can have that have really no meaning? Oh, well, I want to buy a house. Talk to your consultants around you. They're going to tell you about how to go buy your house, how to take good care of yourself, how to build and make increase of your bank account, how to build and make increase of your network and of your reputation. And then all of a sudden, you're going to justify that because somehow you're doing that for His name's sake, and now your whole life is spent on you. With a little, every once in a while, a little, you know, splash of heaven. You hear me? Yeah. A little, you know, minutia of an expression of the Holy Ghost, like a revival in the context of today. Are you listening to me?
Yes.
Did you understand what I just said?
Yes.
Sometimes I look at people and I'm talking by the Spirit of the Lord and I feel like I'm just still speaking a heavenly language and it needs to be interpreted. But I don't know, you know, I don't know how to interpret it anymore. Paul gives two growth plans back in Ephesians chapter 4. He says, if you're going to make the connection, if you'll respond to that which Father supplied, if you'll recognize what it is He's doing, what it is that He's made available to you. This is chapter 4. I'm basically paraphrasing that which I've already quoted, verses 12, 11, 12, and 13. He says, you'll come into the fullness of the measure of the maturity of the ministry of Jesus, even unto a fully matured man. We're talking about growing. Hey, how do I grow in the first place? You know, the Lord gives us the opportunity. He gives us the opportunity to grow in grace, and we grow in grace. How? Because we desire the sincere nourishment that comes by the Word of God. And it's not just reading for intellectual purposes, information only. It's reading to do. It's like reading and saying, Lord, I want to be that. Lord, I want to do that. That's the exact response that He wants. Not, wow, that is amazing that happened. Lord, you're just, it's too bad you're not here today. It would be wonderful to be around you. It's not for the purpose of just being able to quote verses of Scripture. It's for us to be able to behold the image and the glory that Father has given us the opportunity to express in every dimension of who He Himself is. That is unimaginable. To recognize that He's given us the authority and the power to be sons, to be one with Him. But you know what? You know what's not going to be so attractive here? I'm going to tell you in just a minute. Then not only are you called to be one with Him, but you're called to be one with each other. And oh, no. Now it's not so glamorous looking anymore. In fact, He says, you don't even get to be one with me if you're not willing to be one with each other. Father lays it down. In terms of how you and I interact with each other, how we connect with each other, as to how we're connecting with Him. And when people want to carry offense, and you know, it's like men have learned, we're born in sin and shaped in iniquity, to learn how to not like people, the majority of people, the first time they meet them. And then somehow, if you have some kind of, I don't know, some kind of right chemistry, or, you know, they got other little phrases for these things, you know, where you just make this connection, there's a few people that you really connect with and you're on the same page. And you know, what is it that they call that? You know, kindred spirits. I don't be kindred spirit with nobody. Are you listening to me? Because it's all based in a human realm. You know, so I like some people don't like, you and I have got to be willing to get so full of the Holy Ghost that we fall in love with people the first second we meet them. I mean, one of the things that I said, Lord, I want to grow and mature in you. So one of the highlights of the things the Spirit of the Lord was telling me was, well, why don't you learn how to fall in love with everybody you meet in the first 5 seconds? Because otherwise, you're going to respond to that which you were born in and which you were shaped in before you were born in righteousness to be shaped in purity. You're going to go back to that influence that the God of this world, the Spirit of this world that now works in the children of disobedience was imposed upon you. And you're going to be critical and you're going to be suspicious and you're going to find every flaw as you examine them for the first or whatever. Yep. Why is it that so many people don't like people as soon as they meet them? It's an animal instinct. It's purely demonic. Are you listening to me?
Yes.
Sniffing around and such. Looking at every imperfection. My. It's time to get out of that mess. It's time to get out of that mess. Poor Paul. Look at him, man. He's like, well, what's wrong with you people? Do you know what the definition of carnal is? Let me tell you the definition of carnal. It's not meathead.
it's not sinful. We know what definition of carnal is, as Paul described it in the Word, in the context of the Word. Being a baby in Christ. Being a baby when you should already be mature. That's carnal. Being a baby. Being a baby. Right? 1 Corinthians chapter 3. Everybody knows the scripture enough to recognize what I'm talking about, right? You're just all caught up in who you, what church you go to, denomination you go to, who's your favorite leader. You all sorted out based upon what color of jelly bean you are or whatever. Huh? And he said, are you not living in this strife, living in these divisions, rather, living in these divisions? Are you not carnal? Are you not babes? Are you not walking as mere men? When are we going to stop? When are we going to say, wait a minute, I'm going to know myself after the Spirit? Because most people just want to continue to know themselves after all their flaws and all their failures and all the things that everybody told you from preschool on about you. Do you know a lot of who you think you are was formed by the insults of people around you? Huh? And by the opinions and the dreams and the vicarious living of your parents? What a bonded system. What a prison. Jesus said, I've come to set you free. I hope this has got new meaning for you this morning. I've come to liberate you. You will know the truth, and the truth will liberate you. I've come to tell you who you really are. All the stuff that you've got up to this point, lies, nothing but lies, nothing but things running distractions so that you can't be who I've called you to be. Nothing but distractions trying to lead you away to be something different. All sin is Satan coming to try to interrupt the glory of God to be made manifest through you. That's all it is. All these things that belong to partialities and schisms and ideologies, just interruptions of the satanic power trying to stop you from yielding to the supply that's coming down from heaven. And we haven't grown up enough to recognize the tricks of Satan to say, hey, buddy, out of here. I got you. I know who you are. You're not messing with me. I love the supply of that which is coming from heaven. I want to be used by God. I mean, I walk along through this life in the stores and in the highways and the byways of life, and I see so many people struggling in pain under the stronghold and affliction of the satanic realm. Jesus has come to be manifested to destroy the works of darkness, and he was manifested to destroy the works of the devil. And it's time that a greater anointing of God's supply begin to be expressed through the midst of his people. Revival's got to start somewhere. I have a different definition of revival than most people have. Revival for me isn't somebody running around hollering, excited about the presence of God. I love running around hollering and being excited about the presence of God, but that is not in revival. Revival is stepping back into all the things that God has given to us in our inheritance. Revival is returning to that which he supplied. What has he supplied? Baptism of the Holy Ghost, full expression of all of his glory and of all of his power to function in all the realms of his own person. That's revival. To begin to walk in these signs and wonders and demonstration of the power of the Holy Ghost so that Jesus is fully preached and Jesus is fully revealed. To where every one of the works of Jesus, the raising of the dead, the opening of the eyes of the blind, the setting of the captives free in every dimension that we can even imagine. I'm going to tell you right now, one day, if Jesus was here in the United States of America for 1 week, the whole United States of America would be changed. And he's not going to come in person. He's going to come through you and me. And for him to come through you and me in the fullness of that which would result in such a thing, you and I got to stop being you and me.
Yes.
And that's hard for us. It's hard to accept because we just want to go ahead and be you and me. We'll make our own judgments, our own opinions. Well, the preacher told me I needed to change. They corrected me. And so I just decided to go leave the meeting, go hang out in the parking lot. Or not come back the next night because I don't want to come back because what's going to happen is somebody's going to point out the thing I need to change to be like God. The thing I need to change to receive the supply of heaven so that I can begin to walk in all the fullness. The attitude adjustments that I need. The behavior adjustments that I need. The wrong choices that I've been making. I need somebody not to just point it out by suggestion. I really need it to be kind of put up on the overhead so people can see the things that need to be changed about me so I can abhor it because now everybody else gets to look at my grossness. Are you listening to me?
Yes.
Does that shock you? Does that shock you? Are you listening to me?
Yeah.
Because I'm going to tell you right now, when you begin to behold the beauty and the glory, you'll say as Job, even though God said he's perfect and he's upright, when Job has another encounter with God and beholds the beauty and the glory of God, he says, my comeliness, my beauty is now turned into defilement, corruption. I abhor it. Hello?
Yes.
I mean, are you feeling really special right now? Did you know humanism, the spirit of humanism demands me to make you feel special. The spirit of humanism demands me to make you feel positive about yourself, to always keep you happy and to think happy thoughts and to be successful because you are you. So we're here to celebrate you. That's the spirit of humanism that dominates the church today so that Christ Jesus is not being revealed. And so there's darkness and gross darkness over the land. But Father's going to rise and the glory's going to fill the land again. It's going to happen. Why? Because somebody, somewhere, beside a few preachers who've got this word in their mouth and in their heart that's been placed there by the Spirit of the living God, are going to begin to cooperate with what Father wants. You know, if I was just making this up as I go, you could be suspicious. But when you're reading it from the word, all suspicion should come to an end. Are you listening to me?
Yes.
He says, here's what Father's purpose. He's giving you this supply that's come from the head. Somebody back in what we call the latter rain revival, you know, there was the men of God, were wonderful men of God, and I'm not in any way talking down towards them in any way, but they just talked about the fivefold ministry as being the hand ministry, the hand of God reaching out to touch you, shape you, form you, apostle, prophet, evangelist, pastors, and teachers. And though that fits very nicely and that could be understood in that respect, it's still the mouthpiece ministry of God. It's the working mouthpiece ministry of God, so declaring the word of God, because it's really always going to come back to that. Are you going to be willing to hear the word of God and believe the word of God? The word of God was preached to Israel. It did not profit them. Why? Because it wasn't mixed with faith. What happened? They continued on in their unbelief. What fueled their unbelief? Maybe we don't realize this, but in Hebrews chapter 3 and Hebrews chapter 4, God reveals to us what fueled their unbelief. They're murmuring and complaining. I'm going to tell you right now, you're murmuring and complaining. You're speaking evil with your lips. You're speaking guile, your criticism. You're just bringing someone into, you know, just bringing them into question through your conversation. All of that says, God says, is unrighteous. It's wicked. He said, come, children, hearken unto me. I will teach you the fear of the Lord. What man is he that desires life, the life of God, and would love to see the life, eternal life, the many good days? Keep your tongues from evil, and that you literally speak no guile. Depart from evil and pursue peace. And what he's talking about the relationship that Father has given to us to have with each other. And if we're not willing to have that, we're just shutting God down because we took on offense, because we took on unforgiveness, because somehow we had a relationship problem with people around us and we were not willing to lay down our life for them and allow the Holy Ghost to flow through us and heal them if they needed to be healed, or just simply be of an understanding and wise heart to recognize they didn't mean what you thought they meant. Most people don't even understand what the many different meanings and contexts that when you speak, that people understand what you said in. You hear me? You said something, and how many different people understood it differently? You said one thing, and then, four or five people, most of them all understood it different. Communication is a very fragile thing. And now, you know, one word and you're offended by it. One word and you're now got a broken relationship. One word and you're now upset. One wrong look. You know, God help us. Amen. The Lord help us. What is that an evidence of? It's an evidence that we're walking in the realms of self, self-preservation, self-interest, rather than being willing to walk over here in the realms of the Holy Ghost and do the will of the Father. And people just want to make it, they just want to say, they want to, I understand that there's five different usages of the word flesh in the New Testament. Jesus was manifested in the flesh. There wasn't anything bad about that. Are you with me?
Yes.
And hallelujah. He suffered in the flesh. Amen. And there's the flesh of birds and the beast. Amen. The flesh of human beings, all different types of flesh. Then there's the flesh of a demonic realm. And we just use the word flesh, and then there's flesh where suddenly people say, well, that's a, you know, they actually use it. It's not actually a scriptural reference, but now there's a fifth flesh reference that has been made up through
Christian philosophy, that's where you're going back to the satanic nature, because many people believe that you are still have two natures. You have a holy nature, a heavenly nature, God nature, and a satanic nature. That's hard to be one when the devil's living on the inside of you. It's hard to get God the Holy Ghost to bunk with him. I mean, my goodness, you know. And then, you know, back, I remember whoever's team you're rooting for, they're winning. Hopefully that you're rooting for the Holy Ghost today so that he can be winning. But if tomorrow you're rooting for the demon spirit, he's, it's just crazy, confusing things. But the reality of it is, and the reality of it is, I like to just sort out words so people understand exactly what the biblical meanings are. And Jesus said that we must deny ourselves. He didn't say you must deny your flesh. Huh? And did you know that Jesus manifested in flesh? Huh? Did you know that? And that's good. Did you know that many doctrines that had imposed their philosophies on early church doctrine believed that Jesus could not be manifested in the flesh because the flesh was innately evil? But when we're talking about Jesus being made manifested in the flesh, we can also talk about him being made manifest in our flesh.
Amen.
Woo. Woo. What is that? Now what am I talking about? I'm talking about my body. Yeah. My flesh is his temple. Oh, you can't use that word. Oh, yeah, I can, because I'm not a Gnostic. I'm not a student of Aristotle and Socrates. I don't care what Plato and Philo said. I'm only interested in what Jesus said. I want to get all their mess out of the way so I can understand what he's saying, so I can begin to be responsible for my behavior and my actions and my attitudes and my responses to him. He said, I want you to deny yourself, take up your cross daily, and follow me if you want to be my disciple. And he fundamentally makes the biggest part of that how you and I, the one command, how we love each other just like he loved us. And I'm going to tell you right now, that being the chief of all God's purpose for us will deal with every issue that you have and everything that arises on any given day. Because you're going to say, Holy Ghost, fill me with your love right now. You know how? You know what? If you were really keeping track, you probably offended about 1,000 times in a day. You know? And probably nothing can hardly happen that you don't get offended by. Every once in a while, something happens and you didn't get offended by it and get happy. Wow, I really like this person. For one moment, you didn't get. I'm really, because we're walking over in a realm of discerning things after our own perceptions and our own ideas. And we've been willing to allow ourselves to be developed in that. We were born in sin and shaped in iniquity. We weren't born in righteousness now to continue to be shaped in iniquity. We were born in righteousness when we were born of the Spirit. We were born in righteousness and true holiness. Now to be shaped by the Holy Spirit, to be shaped by the living Word of God, to be shaped by the hand and the presence of the Almighty. That means everything about you has to change. Oh, God, speak to me. Then he speaks to you, you're offended, because most of the things he's going to be saying to you, you got to change. Hello? Hello? If you could just settle that, now you can be more comfortable with the process. But it's always a reward. It's always good. Because he's saying, I don't want you to be like you. I want you to be like me. I don't want you to behave like a devil. I want you to behave like God the Holy Ghost. Huh? Shouldn't be a hard choice. And when you think about it, if you think, it wouldn't be a hard choice. If somebody's standing there, well, you want to act like a demon right now, or would you like to act like God? Huh? You'd go, oh, I want to act like a devil. No, you would not. He would not. I want to behave myself after the image of the and likeness of God. He's predestinated me to be conformed to the image of the Son. So that he might be the firstborn among many brethren. We're going to have some revelation of some brethren, I'm telling you right now. Because that's what Romans 8:29 is talking about. He brought forth this glory inside of you and me that all men might see that a whole new family has arisen.
Yeah.
Come on. I'm going to dance. I'm going to tell you what. From here on in, you guys are off the hook. I'm going to dance for you. I'm going to shout for you. I'm going to do what the rock should be doing on your behalf. Are you with me?
Yes.
Come on, man. And then after a while, you'll get so tired of just sitting there watching. Hopefully you're not 90 years old by then. You'll say, I'm going to get up and do something too. I'm going to start moving around too. I'm going to start getting excited about God. You don't respond because it hasn't become a living reality to you yet. When these things become a practice, they become a living reality. They don't become a living reality just because you read it. It becomes a living reality. Doesn't it make sense? Because you practice it. It became a living reality because you did it.
Amen.
Hallelujah.
Hallelujah.
Yes. Sit around. Just sit around. Your body thinks you're dying. Just sit around. Stop moving. Your body thinks it's dying. That's why all of a sudden your joints aren't working anymore. You're sore. You start moving around. It's like, oh. You start getting overweight. Your blood vessels begin to clog up. Your body thinks you're dying. You're not moving. I mean, come on, people. There's a spiritual application here. You know, come on. I'm on my wife's nutrition and exercise program, and I mean, it's pretty difficult to keep up with. God, the Holy Ghost, has got a nutrition and exercise program for us that we're going to have to be all in to even begin to even crawl, much less run. It's about time God's people start crawling. I'm going to tell you right now, that's revival. When I see God's church, just start crawling. Sloth crawl. Revival, full-blown revival. Because right now it kind of looks like everybody's just sitting around. It's not activated. It's not a living reality. It's not a living reality. I mean, I've been in so many places where, I mean, the Lord allowed me to travel with most all the leaders that he raised up in the 80s and the 90s. And I've seen so many things go on, and I've seen so very few people follow on to know the Lord. Follow on in passionate pursuit of him. They're just happy to, you know, have the joy, have the excitement, have the thrill, see the miracles. But how about the moving on? How about the growing? How about the maturing? How about the conforming of the image? How about being willing to live in the Spirit and walk in the Spirit? How about being willing to give all diligence to making your calling and election sure, because you recognize the kind of humility that God has? He wants it to be seen in you, and that's something that you're going to give yourself to having and developing and maturing in. As Peter said in 2 Peter chapter 1, we received the divine nature. We've escaped the corruption that is in the world through lust. I don't believe that most people in church even know that. I mean, John said, we know that everybody that's born of God doesn't sin. Nobody knows that. Nobody knows that, because they're too fascinated with the world to be captivated by the glory. And John's talking about what it looks like when you're captivated by the glory and living over here in the realms of his splendor and his abundant life. We're trying to mitigate living in this world and being conformed to this world with the idea and concept of being transfigured by thinking different. Because there's too much conforming going on, people. Are you listening to me? Yes. And it's, when you begin to give yourself to walking in love, all of a sudden it stands out. It's not difficult. Just begin to give yourself to walking in love. Begin to see, you know, Peter said we've escaped the corruption that's in the world because we've been given his divine nature. We've been made partakers, participating with his divine nature. We've escaped the corruption that is in the world through lust. Now add unto you virtue. And he says, now give yourself, give all diligence to growing in godliness and growing in this realm of purity and growing in this realm of humility. Jesus says, come and learn of me. I'm meek and lowly. Who likes that? Who likes meek and lowly? We were shaped in pride and arrogance and self-will. God's, when we were born in sin and shaped iniquity, we were born and shaped in that. Now, Father says, now that you've been born in righteousness, been born in the Spirit, to have the new birth, I want to shape you in lowliness and meekness and submission. I want to shape you in this humility. I want to shape you in this brotherly love and this kindness. I want to shape you in this willingness to be servants, obedient servants. So Paul's describing the right connection. You grow in the fullness. Here you go. Till we come into the fullness of the measure of the maturity of the ministry. Not just the fullness of the measure, the maturity of the lifestyle or the character or the conduct, but the ministry. These are all volumetric words, really. Fullness of the measure, the maturity, the ministry of Jesus, even unto a fully matured man. See, that's plan A. That's plan A. Okay, next verse is plan B. And verse 14 is plan B. And most people are taking plan B so that you don't remain children, constantly aggravated, constantly tripped up and distracted and carried away by the things that men are doing, the lies that they're telling, the tricks that they're pulling. Huh? Are you listening to me?
Yes.
Come on, people. Then what are we going to do here? Are we going to sit here and stare at the two gates for how long? For how long? How long will we stare at the gate? Well, there's gate A, fullest measure of maturity, the ministry of Jesus, and there's gate B. Children, constantly distracted and tricked and living frustrated lives. Huh? Which one do I want to be? And by default, you're already in B. Are you listening to me? Yeah. By default, you're like already in B. Really, it should by default, you're already in A. But that means that you're going to have to deny yourself and take up your cross and follow him. That means you're going to live totally different. That means every day it's about conforming to his will. It's about every day learning how to move and flow and operate in the things which God is supplying. You know what he's supplying? Praying with all prayer in the Holy Ghost. Praying with all prayer and supplication in the Holy Ghost. He's supplying that. What is he supplying? He's supplying the effulgency of his divine life and his glory to us so that we can now build up ourselves in the most holy faith, praying in the Holy Ghost. The supply that comes through the divine working of the power of God through prayer in our life, where the Holy Ghost is praying through us. And we all bored and don't have time for it. And Jesus finds his whole life identity and purpose in it. He ever lives to make intercession for the saints. I mean, Jesus finds his whole life and purpose in it. Are you listening to me? I keep saying that because I'm doubtful. I'm just telling you. I wanted to go, and I'm not talking about what you can understand with your intellect. I'm talking about what you can understand with your spirit, what you can begin to apply and do, because you're going to have to be willing to change. You're going to have to come to a place of submission to God that says, no more am I going to continue to be what I've been.
Yeah.
Try to change yourself. Try to change one behavior about tomorrow. You're going to blow it. You're going to blow it. Even though you know it's bad, you're going to blow it. You need help. I got a door on one of my tractors that broke. And it got mishandled. So I locked it from the outside so I can't get into it. Because you know why? Every time I get into that tractor, I'm going to forget. Because it's a habit. I'm going to go to that I'm going to go to that door. And praise God, I got it locked. Oh. But inside, you can open it. And you open it and it falls off. How many times am I going to do this? It's habits. It's behavior. It's you and I left to our own sense of remembering. Praise God that the Holy Ghost has come to help our remembering, bring us into remembrance of these things. But we're going to have to start acknowledging him. We're going to have to start saying, Holy Spirit, when we wake up in the morning, oh God, I need you desperately. I can't do anything without you. God, I want to get this right. Holy Ghost, take hold of me. Holy Ghost. Caused me to grab a hold of the things that you made and gave an opportunity for me to have.
Hallelujah.
You can either live under the word and diagnosis of men, or you can live under the word and diagnosis of God. You can either live under the concepts that you and everybody else around you invent about you, or you can live under the purposes and the mandate, hallelujah, and the prophetic word, the prophecy, and the new creation that God has given you. Hallelujah. Come on, people. You and I, we're supposed to have rivers of God flowing out of us, baptized in the Holy Ghost and fire, walking in the word of wisdom, word of knowledge, the discerning of spirits, all the wonderful manifestation, the supernatural working of the power of God, just in the same ministry of Jesus Christ, and we're willing to sell out for other things and justify it. No. No. It's time to change. Look with me in a verse of scripture in 1 Thessalonians chapter 3. And because there's absolutely no end to this command in Scripture. And to exhaust all that God has to say about the increase, the supply of the Spirit that comes because we're willing to simply walk in love, it's just impossible. It's the chief theme of the Word of God. And so let me see if I can find the verse of Scripture that I want to share with you real quickly here. And he says in verse 11, God himself and the Lord Jesus, let's see, Christ, direct our way unto you, and the Lord make you to increase and abound in love one towards another and towards all men, even as we do towards you, for this purpose, that you may establish your hearts unblameable in holiness before God. Think about this. Think about the emphasis that God is placing on love. And just quickly go to Ephesians chapter 3, and then we're going to come back to Ephesians chapter 4, and I'm going to finish that verse of scripture here in just a minute. Go to Ephesians chapter 3. Hallelujah. I'm going to just tell you right now, I put love above joy. I'm going to tell you right now, I put love above peace. I'm going to tell you right now, I put love above everything.
Yeah.
I believe that it fulfills all things. I believe it fulfills all the law and prophets. I believe it's the fundamental issue of how you and I are going to begin to cooperate with God, and it changes every dimension of how we behave ourselves, how we think, and how we conduct ourselves before God and before men and in our interaction with one another. Listen to me. I believe this, that on that day, what you're going to do is you're going to give an account for how well you loved. You hear me? On that day, when you stand before the Lord, you're going to give an account to Him for how well you loved. Do you need some help? Anybody need help here? The helper's here. Praise God. The helper's come. Now you can really understand the value of the helper. If you don't need any help, I mean, what's the value of a helper? I mean, when you can do all things by yourself, who needs a helper? Well, when you begin to realize I can do nothing without Him. And when I begin to realize that, yeah, I've been given a new heart and I've been given a new spirit, but I need the Holy Ghost. I need to come under His rulership. I need to understand the fundamental practical principles of how to yield to Him, how to respond to that which the Holy Ghost is supplying, that which Christ Jesus is supplying, so that I can be and have that overflow that Jesus described as rivers, which are the expressions of God's life. In every dimension of His supply, He fills us up with so much more than we can contain. It busts out of us like rivers. It's not just dripping over the sides. I'm telling you, it busts loose. With all heaven, come on, man. This is Papa's cry. And all He wants you and I to do is just get so captivated by it, we're thinking about it all day long. We pray. Revival is in the atmosphere. The moving of God is in the atmosphere. Sovereign moving of God is about to be unleashed upon the church. Yeah. I believe in the continuous flow and moving of God. Listen to me. I believe in the continuous flow and movings of God. I believe in that. Continuous flow and movings of God. The Word of God teaches that. But there's sovereign movings of God where all of a sudden Father just begins to captivate the hearts of the world, if you would. And as people begin to flow in an anointing and a greater description of His power and glory. I've experienced this in some small ways. Let me just tell you. I've traveled, when I was traveling with Carlos Anacondia, there were certain giftings in my life that had never been so radically explosive as they were just being around him. Because under that, because he had this flow, this miracle anointing that God had given him specifically for the work that he was given to do. Okay? And so when I'm with him and I'm hooked up with that, serving him, that it just effortlessly, that gifting that normally wasn't that strong and that explosive just flowed through me because I was just in that connection with him. And I'm saying the same way. God the Father begins to move, and He comes with His overshadowings. I'm telling you right now. And those people who have been cultivating the fruit that He wants and who've been crying out and who've been pursuing those things that He desires, suddenly we're now moving with Him effortlessly. I'm telling you, there is a continuous supply, but you and I have got to understand how to get connected, because God could come sovereignly, and if you're not cultivating what He's cultivating, if you're not connected with Him in the things that He's purposed to do, if your heart's off on something else and your heart's off seeking man and seeking things, then he comes, you're not able to receive that which the supply of the Spirit is giving. You're not holding the head, you're holding something else. You're not looking to Christ Jesus, you're looking to something else. It's not all about him, it's about other things. See, there were those Paul addressed in Colossians chapter 2, they weren't holding Christ Jesus in his proper place. Therefore, because they weren't holding him in his proper place, that which only he can supply to cause them to grow and increase with the increase of God, to grow with the growing of God or the growth of God, wasn't realized by them. Look here in Ephesians 3, and I'm going to go back to Ephesians 4 in just a minute. I want you to just grab this. I'm telling you right now, if I gave you all the verses of Scripture rushing through my heart that are on this issue right here, it's inexhaustible. I mean, the volume of the book is about Jesus, and he comes to manifest the love of God. He that dwells in God dwells in what?
dwells in love. Think about this. I mean, look at how God has, look at how simplified it is. Look at how all influential it is. How it would govern, if we would allow love of the Holy Ghost to govern us, how it would impact every single action and dimension of our life. Just one simple thing. God's love. Not any other kind of love. God's love. The way he defined it. Not the way a dictionary defines it. The way he defines it. And expressed it when Jesus went and bore our sins in his own body on the tree. That when we were yet enemies, alienated from him, he commended his love towards us. Hallelujah. Come on, don't you think about this, because God wants you to apply that. He wants you to be doing that. He wants you to get beside of yourself. He wants you to get so out of yourself. He wants you to know yourself so much after the Spirit that you just say, for me to live is Jesus. You're seeing Jesus over here. Somebody said, well, I'm seeing all kinds of faults and failures. That's because you're looking with the wrong kinds of eyes. You're looking with the wrong kind of perception. I know myself after the Spirit. I no longer live. It's Jesus that lives over here. Amen. You're going to have to start agreeing with God before it's ever going to become a reality. The miracle of the Word will never take place until you first agree with the Word. Amen. You listen to me. The miracle outworking of the Word will never take place until you first agree with the Word. As long as it's sometime in the future, as long as it's somewhere else, as long as somehow you've got to do this or do that to have it, as long as it's put off to another day, it's never going to be a reality. It's got to be today. It's got to be now. He's a now God, the today God. Today is the time. It's actually, he's already done it. It's mine. And I accept and receive it. And everything that you've accepted and received that God has declared, you've received the outworking of that miracle has come. Sometimes it was immediate and instantaneously. Sometimes it was by you holding on to what God said and not looking on the outward things. And I'm talking about various different areas of healing for your body, increase for your finances, spiritual growth and maturity. Because you stayed with God's word. No, I'm not backing down. No, I'm not turning. No, I'm not going to go to the right or to the left. No, I have no latitude but to obey God and walk in his word. And it's a very narrow way. It's not a broad path. It's a very narrow way. It's a very exact footstep that he wants me to make. It's a very exact walk that he's called me to come into. Now look in Ephesians chapter 3 real quickly with me. You know, and the Lord builds us up. Look at, and you've got to establish it in verse 16. To be strengthened by the Spirit in your inner being. I'm going to tell you right now, because if you're not receiving that which he's supplying, if you're not willing to receive, if you're not willing to look to him, none of these things are going to happen. Listen to me. Look at this next verse of scripture. I want everybody, instead of quoting it, I want you to turn there. I see some people, I'm doubtful that you turned there, so I'm going to model this for you. Turn there. Praise God. Now, it looks like that everybody's praying. Thank you very much for getting the Bible out and turning. I want you to look. Because I don't want to be like the prophet who was able to play well on the viola, and everybody loved to hear the music, but no one did what was said. I want to be the person that God uses to touch your life in such a way that you hear the word and you begin to do the word, because the hearer is not justified. You're not going to make heaven being a hearer. That's right. You're going to make heaven being a doer. You're not going to grow and increase in God because you're a hearer. You're going to grow and increase in God because you're a doer. Hallelujah. We look here in this verse scripture of Ephesians chapter 3 in verse 17. That Christ may dwell in you by faith. That ye being rooted and grounded in love. Listen. Be strengthened by the Spirit. Can I give it to you this way? Be strengthened by the Spirit in your inner man so that you will recognize and realize that Christ Jesus, of an absolute truth and certainty, that Christ Jesus dwells in your heart. You hear me? That miracle working of faith, where you see things the way God sees them rather than see things the way that men sees them. Seeing things the way that God sees them, that's the faith realm. It's a supernatural realm that is delivered to us by what? The Word. What is the Word of God? The Word of God is the ability to see things and understand things the way God sees them and understands them. Do you understand what I'm driving at here with the miracle realm of faith, the provision of faith? Being rooted and grounded in love. What kind of love? The same love that Jesus loved us with. By this all men will know that you are my disciples. What kind of love? The love wherewith I have loved you. The same love that the Father has loved me. I'm showing you what this love looks like. Having this love one for another. Now,
You're so established. If you're rooted and grounded, how much are you going to move around? If you're rooted, huh? Can you look at the trees? There he goes. There he goes. There he goes. There he goes. I hope he stays. You see all these trees running around. I want to be planted somewhere differently. Just go out and just imagine all the trees, pull the roots up out of the ground, they're running around everybody. What confusion. We used to sing the song when I was little. Just like a tree that's planted by the waters, I shall not be moved. Oh, I shall not be moved forever. Right? You remember that? Father's looking for us to get some deep, 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 deep roots. We're so anchored in this. We have no latitude of budget, no latitude of moving, no opportunity to have any other response, no rights to have any other response, because we come under the sovereign rule of Almighty God. He's more than Lord. He's master. He's more than governor. He's ruler. You think about it. I don't even have the right to decide for myself. I've been bought with a price. I'm not my own. I'm the purchased possession of Almighty God to glorify Him in my flesh, my body, and in my spirit, which are His. Think about it. Now I no longer live according to the will of man, but I live according to the will of God. You're going to suffer in the flesh saying no to your own will. You hear me? That's what Peter said, 1 Peter chapter 4. But he that suffered in the flesh has ceased from sin. He no longer lives in life according to the will of men, but according to the will of God. The tension. Now, I've come to do only thy will. If you will recognize that Father places, that Jesus places this above everything else, to do the will of the Father. He says, everyone who says, Lord, Lord, is to say this. Christ Jesus is absolutely my Lord. Isn't going to enter into the kingdom of heaven. But those who do the will of the Father. Think about that. Because it should send shockwaves of revelation to your spirit. It should create within you, you know, holy fear and godly consecration to do things God's way and to quit having the flexibility to do it your way. To be rooted and grounded in love. And there, all revelation comes to you. That you may know what is the height, the breadth, the length, the depth. Of what? The love of Christ. The love of Christ. These are absolutely connected. To know the height, the breadth, the length, the depth. To know all the fullness of God. Every dimension of God is only found in. And it is completely revealed in. Knowing the love of Christ. But you're not going to know the love of Christ until you get consecrated to love. So that you don't have any latitude of movement. You don't have any other choices but to love. You consecrated to it. You live under it. That means that you suddenly, you know, I told people a long time ago, go get yourself a roll of Gorilla Tape at Home Depot. I mean, I'll tell you right now, the vow of silence among the Catholics wasn't a bad idea. To where that every one of your words become a sacrifice before the Lord. It's like the offering, or is it like the evening and the morning sacrifice? Every word becomes something that is sacred and holy. Jesus said, I'm going to tell you right now, you're going to give an account for every word that you say, even the things that you said in jesting and jokes. Ha, ha, ha. You're going to give an account for them because it's a sacred realm. What's coming out of your mouth? I want to teach you how to speak life, words of life. I want to teach you how to live out this beauty and this splendor and this glory, and everything about you's got to change. I just, that was a KO knockout punch to humanism. The principality, an angel of darkness called humanism, reigns over the United States of America today. Feminism also reigns. We've allowed it. And the rebellion and the pride and the haughtiness. And the clenched fist that is in its expressions towards God is almost on the same level of Nimrod and his rebellion defiance against God. That's how people can walk out of the meeting and go stand in the parking lot all night. It's clenched fist towards God. You don't even know it. You're coming under an evil spirit. Don't even know it. Think about it. Think about it, dear people.
Father's calls us to come, live under the governorship of that is that every of that which is opposite to everything that is in this world. Hallelujah. This is what the Spirit of the Lord is saying to the churches. This is what the Spirit of the Lord is saying to you individually, to the church. He wants you to find your place in the body of Christ so you can begin to fully exercise and function in that which He's called you to be and to do. Now I'm going to finish this and I'm going to go back to Ephesians 4. I'm going to try to finish this quickly. It's hard for me to do anything quickly. Being rooted and grounded in love. May be able to comprehend with all saints what is the height, the breadth, the length, the depth. To know the love of Christ, which passes your ability to understand intellectually, which passes knowledge. In this love, living in this love, walking in this love, this connection with God, this supply of the Holy Ghost, you may be filled with all the fullness of God. See the supply? See the connection? I'm connected with what? His love. I'm consecrated to it. I'm committed to it. I'm rooted and grounded. I'm connected. I'm not going to budge from this spot and from this place. This is where God wants me to live. This is where God wants me to be. Jesus said, above all things, this is how men are going to know that you are my disciples. I don't want you to budge from this place. And I want you to understand you're going to be doing something that you cannot do of yourself. You have to be filled with and baptized in the Holy Ghost. You first and foremost have to have a new spirit and be born totally anew and become one with the Father and filled with the Holy Ghost to even be able to have this. Now you got to look to the right source now, huh? Because what's going to come to us and what's going to be supplied to us is from Christ Jesus to be able to do this. And so he goes on, now unto him who is super abundantly able to do, super abundantly above all that you can think or ask. Look at that's the first next verse of scripture. See, now he's saying to us very clearly, according to the power that is at work on the inside of us. So Christ is in us. He's in us. He's living on the inside of us. Amen. Hallelujah. You're going to have to get out of debt. If you're in doubt about that, we want to fix that doubt right now. Satan's come to claim you, put his name on you, make you something different than Jesus. We want to get rid of that right now. Today, you don't want to leave here thinking that you belong to anyone other than God and that your life is anything other than about the life of Jesus. If there's that kind of doubt and unbelief going on in your life, if there's that kind of power of Satan at work in your life, we'll run that off. God has given us authority over all unclean spirits, over all the powers of darkness to destroy their work so they cannot no longer hold you under their power and under their grip. There's a power. It's so beautiful how that Paul brings it right down to a place that's right here with us that we don't have to somehow ascend up into heaven to bring him down. Or to send down into the uttermost parts of the earth to bring him up. But what does the word of the Lord say? He's near. He's near to you. He's very near. Where? In your heart and in your mouth. Even this word of faith. Hallelujah. Basto remai. To declare those things which God's declaring. To speak those things which God is speaking. And to give yourself to living and being what God described. To recognize, wait a minute. I'm crucified with him. I'm buried with him by baptism into his death. I'm raised up together with him. I'm alive together with him. I'm seated in the heavenly realm with him. My conversation is heaven. My lifestyle is in heaven. Hallelujah. My citizenship is in heaven. Hallelujah. I'm one with him. I'm in him. I'm living in his glory. Come on now. Hallelujah. Come on. Get out of all the other stuff that will try to invade your life through the thoughts and thinking realm. Grab a hold of the shield of faith by which you're able to quench every fiery dart of the wicked one. All the other suggestions and all the other lies and all the other opinions and all the other stuff that is going to cause you to be anything less than what Jesus purchased you to be and what the Holy Ghost is supplying you to be and to become. Now go back to Ephesians 4. There's a connection. He's supplying something. It's coming right from the head. It's coming right down from the head. Keep it in context. The context is two growth plans. You can come in the fullness of the measure of maturity, the ministry of Jesus, into a fully matured man. That's a lot of growth, isn't it?
Yeah.
Or you can remain like you are. That's no growth plan. Babies.
constantly doing the same things that are described to babies. Always complaining, doubtful, unbelieving, no power. If the proof of heaven was revealed to the power in your life, there would be none. Are you listening to me?
Yes.
Come on now. You got to get a person responsible for these things. Are you listening to me?
Yes.
Am I talking too fast?
No.
Come on. Don't be foreigners and strangers anymore. Come on in here. Come in. Come on in here. Hallelujah. I don't want to give you any wiggle room here today.
Amen.
I want you to be able to leave out of here thinking that you can somehow be anything other than completely grounded and rooted in love and committed and consecrated to it without any other choices. You don't, when all of a sudden you say, I am going to live to do the will of the Father, you don't give yourself any more choices anymore. You don't consult yourself about what your action, next action is going to be. You don't have any say in it. What do you say, Pop? What did you say, Father, in your word? Huh? If you want to go to hear a prophet, say something. God's delivered his word and put his prophet on the inside of you. Come on, that's give me a break. Huh? Come to his word. Hear what it is that he's saying, calling us to be and calling us to do. Because this great outpouring of God, this great moving of the Spirit of God is not that far away. The question is whether or not you're going to participate with it. Whether or not you're going to be right in the big middle of it. Oh, my God. Father, shake us right now. Shake us with the reality. Listen to me. Just look at me. Let me pray. You look at me. Father, shake us with the reality of those things that you purposed us to do so we can go start putting the lost on assignment for heaven. Because you've got people. God's got handpicked people right now that don't even know God. I saw a girl yesterday in a store, and I've been praying for her all morning. Long dreads. Beautiful girl, just all long, matted dreads. Just deep pain and hurt in her eye, and I heard in my spirit, my anointing's upon her to bring her into those great manifestations of my spirit and my power that are about to be unleashed upon the earth. You know, this is happening all around us. God's got people handpicked. He's handpicking them right now. He's handpicking them all around us right now. I would not want to be left out of the great outpourings of the Spirit and the move of God. I've always given myself to say I want to be right at ground zero no matter what. The Lord's always allowed me. The Lord's always allowed me. I can take you back. I can prove it to you. The Lord's always allowed me to be at ground zero of his movings, of his outpourings, of the things that he's doing. He's always used me on an assignment to see now who will follow on and know him. Who will pursue on and know who, how many people are going to be offended at the word. How many people are going to suddenly decide they're going to go away because all of a sudden God, the Holy Ghost, starts saying, eat my flesh and drink my blood. Because a lot of people leave then. A lot of people go. Are you listening to me?
Yes.
Multitudes were fed with many loaves and with a few loaves and fishes. Hallelujah. But as soon as he said, eat my flesh and drink my blood, that he may prove them, huh? They left. And the disciples were offended and said, how, this is a hard saying. He said, will you go away also? He said, well we they had enough understanding and realized there was no place to go. Well, we can go to the Pharisees? Where are they gonna go? Go back to the fishing boat? You alone had the words of life. Hukabate. I feel a great shaking of heaven. I feel the power, the same miracle presence to devise the loaves and fishes right now. I feel it. I feel it in the very atmosphere. I feel God's heart, Father's heart, pounding with a passion to display his glory and the magnificence of the name and the power and the authority of Jesus. I'm telling you, his name, the name of Jesus has been effectively rendered powerless in the Western world by the satanic realm operating through the midst of the church. Because the hinder of lawlessness has not been hindering nothing, hardly. Listen to me. I'm telling you that. I'm just giving you something right from heaven. Huh? But Father's about to glorify. Father's about to stand up on his own initiative and glorify the name of his only begotten Son. And he's looking for some people to do it with him because he's going to do it through servants, those who are man. It's always the Lord shorthanded with laborers. Satan went walking to and fro, up and down in all the earth. With a boy, and the inferences there in Job, he's got this boisterous, you know, innuendo of they all serving me. And God's able to say, I got one. I got one guy. That's all he needs. I got one. One man. Have you considered my one man? My servant Job.
Hallelujah. God's always been short-handed. It's about time somebody gets passionate for the kingdom and say, Father, we don't want it to be short-handed anymore. It's about time that more than just one person, it's a whole great mighty army. That's what God has purposed to do.
Amen.
I was praying, crying out to God one day. I guess it was right at about a year and a half ago. It was one of those special moments in the Lord. And I'm saying, God, Father, raise up somebody, just anybody. It don't matter. It don't have to be me. Oh, God, just anybody. Father, find somebody who's willing to go all the way with you so your glory may be seen on the scale that you described in your word, that your name be no longer profaned. The Spirit of the Lord spoke to me. I'm going after it. Because you know what? When you allow the Holy Ghost flow through you, he prays really well. And it's not boring at all. It's actually a very exciting heavenly thing, man. It's supernatural. It's glorious. And the Spirit of the Lord said to me, I will raise up many, not a few. A great army will obey my word and my command. I just hate to think it's the people with the dreads right now and everybody who's sitting in the church is left out. I hate to think that. That those who are first called and have the first option and the first opportunity to know and move with God opted out. Said, no, we want to do it this way. Huh? Well, those people with the dreads and the millennials with the pain in their eye and they're just radical. They're not looking for any conforming to nothing. They just rebel through and through. They're so tired of all the make-believe. They want something that's real. It's going on. You can see it. And suddenly, the Lord says, behold, here am I. They go all in. The revival that goes on in China today is because of the youth that are all in. They have no concept of anything before Christ. It's all in for them to live as Christ. That when they gave their life to Jesus, one child in the family, you think about the uproar within the family because every Chinese family wants their child to go and become something great, become a doctor, it's just an Asian thing, become a lawyer, become something very significant in society. And they're saying, no, I'm going to lay down my life for Jesus on the foreign field. I'm telling you right now, what that results in just is over a million people coming into the kingdom every month in China with well over 200 million and it escalating. We're praising God too because China's about to become one of the world powers, if not the world power. And what the joint exercises that they've been doing with Russia for the past 10 years, the Russian fleet and the Chinese fleet organized and they first 100% integrated, they seamless. We've abdicated. When we abdicated our purpose, we abdicated our power. When we left the one who made us who we are, we left the ability to be preserved. Our military might pales in the alliance between China and Russia. It pales. Their passion to rule the world is just unmatchable. Huh? Unstoppable. And you're not going to hear about anything about that on CNN or Fox News. I remember when I first went to China in 2001, and then I was so blessed to become close friends with one of the professors there, University of Beijing, professor of economics. He was actually a counselor to Hugh's cabinet at the time, who was the ruler of China. And there, his big thing was, and what everybody was saying back then, is by 2020, we will rule the world economically. We will have the greatest military might. We will have the greatest military fleet. We'll have the greatest military aircraft. We'll have the greatest military might on the ground and in the air and on the sea by 2020. And that was their motto. It's 2015, people. Huh? By 2005, they started doing joint military exercises with the People's Republic of China, did a joint military exercise with the Soviet Union. Think about it. I'm just going to think about it. I want you to think about it. We hold on to securities that are not securities at all. We hold on to things that are very easily gone overnight.
if our hope and our trust is in the things of this world and the things of this earth. It's about time God's people voluntarily turn to him because they're passionately in love with him and don't turn to him because it's just a terrible day. Oh, that men would praise the Lord for his goodness and for his wonderful works unto the children of men. You know the psalm? You know the chorus of the psalm? Huh? And the Lord, and because of their sin and their iniquity, the Lord gave them over to their enemies and cruelly afflicted them and dealt severely with them. And they lifted up their voice and they cried unto the Lord, and the Lord heard them and he delivered them. And as soon as they got delivered and everything was good again, they went back to their spiritual fornication and adultery and love for their own life and passion for their own pursuits, because their blindness of heart and blindness of mind and can't see the reality of heaven right before them. People, I don't want you to be stuck in a place where you are living in a deception, in a world painted by demon spirits to imprison you for eternity, filled with lies and everything that Satan and his deceptive power can work to make you believe, when all the time right before you was an opportunity to live in oneness with God in the fullness of his divine glory, to live out the beauty of his life. Hallelujah. To have no hurt, no pain in your eyes, no hurt, no pain in your heart, no hurt, no torment living in your soul, no sickness, no disease, no living under the power of the enemy. Jesus Christ now living inside of you, the one who came and was manifested to destroy the works of the devil, lives on the inside of you, and he's destroyed every work of the devil that would come out against you, and anything that would come against you, destroy that and deliver you there too. He's your provider, your protector, your perfecter. Hallelujah. Your savior, deliverer, your way maker, your healer. He's everything. He's your all in all. He's everything that you desire and everything that you need, being captivated by the life that he's freely given, the supply that comes from him, the head.
Amen.
The next verse of scripture. Verse 16, the Lord says, he really, and I just kind of want to paraphrase it for you, because he just describes the absolute connectivity then that has to exist within the framework of his people and his body, something that he supplies, because he, the head, supplies to every, I think it says in King James, band and joint, but he supplies the nourishment, the provision, that which every ligament needs, so that it is able, by the exercising the full movement and exercise of that which its purpose to do, or the measure that it has, it may also supply. God wants you to, there's something God wants you to supply. He's supplying you something that he wants you to supply that will ultimately result in the increase of the body, the growth of the body. It's actually, the word increase shouldn't be there. It's actually a mistranslation, because it's the same word, growth word, that's used up there in verse 13. You may grow up in him. Or rather, the growth word that is used. Verse 13? Let me just look at it real quickly. I'll find chapter 4 here in a minute. Verse 15. Same word, grow up into him. That's what I said, though, wasn't it? Just needed to check. Sometimes when we're doing stuff, we need to check. Hollywood would make you believe that people worship God on Mount Sinai before God ever appeared to Moses on Mount Sinai. You know that? You need to go check the Bible and make sure that's not whether that's true or not. Are you with me?
Yes.
Because there's all these kind of fictional ideas. You need to constantly check in with the Word. God was never on Mount Sinai until he showed up there because Moses was there. That's it. Are you listening to me? You better watch out how you believe the Bible. As always, go check ourselves, check our actions, check our behavior. There's something God wants to supply to you. Reckon what that is. Wonder what that is that God would like to supply to you. So that it may be so that you may have something to supply.
Amen.
God wants to supply something to you that you then can supply that will result in the growth of his body, which is his church, which is his person revealed in the earth. Think about it. Can you hear me? Which is the fullness of everything that he is. God wants to supply something to you that you can then supply to the body, to everybody around you. What that is. Wonder what that is. Huh? Wonder what that is. Can anybody take a wild guess what that is? Wonder what that is. We've been talking about it all morning. Hallelujah. You got to make a connection so the supply can come to you. You got to make a connection with the Lord Jesus, the way that God described it. You're going to have to make a connection with one another. You make that connection to the supply, you're going to, what's going to happen? You're going to grow. What you're going to end up looking like? The fullness and the measure, the maturity of the ministry of Jesus. What is it going to look like? It's going to look like increase with the increase of God. What is it going to look like? It's going to look like everything that God purposed us to be when he purchased us with his blood, gave us a miracle new birth by this Holy Ghost. Think of it. Hello. Listen to me over here. Don't go away on me. I know Satan has tried to do his perfect work to basically make you lose your attention after 30 seconds. Well, let God, the Holy Ghost, do his perfect work and captivate you so that you never turn away your look or gaze from off him ever again. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Out of the supply, look. Faith that works by love. Out of the supply of this divine love. That's the compassion. When he saw them, he was moved with this deep love, and he healed all of them that were among. Every time that the Lord allows me to begin to move in the gifts of miracles, every time, without fail, I'm overwhelmed by such an amazing, captivating love and compassion. All I can really do is weep. When I'm weeping, I'm under the gift of miracles. If you can't understand it any other way. I'll just give you there, because with every one of his outworkings, there's an expression of the Holy Ghost, and one of the great expressions that's always there is his divine love. I don't want joy without divine love. I don't want peace without divine love. I don't want anything without divine love, because he that dwells in love dwells in God. I want that expression, which is chief among all that God demands. It is his commandment above all other commands. This one new commandment I give unto you, that you love one another just like I loved you. By this all men shall know that you are my disciples. By this you shall be the light of the world, a city set upon a hill that shall not be hid. By this you should be the salt of the earth. By this, that overflowing glory of heaven. Hallelujah. I'm going to tell you, you're not going to find the Holy Ghost outside of love. You're not going to find him one single moment outside of this divine love. I'm earnestly trying to express to you that which I feel from heaven right now. That which I'm trying to put into words that which God, the Holy Ghost, is moving upon my spirit and my very body and being with this awareness that I have of something big's about to happen. I got a sense. Hallelujah. I got a sense. I got a divine sense. It's not a fifth sense, sixth sense, seventh sense. It's a divine sense. I got a divine sense of something's about ready to happen. The Holy Ghost, who's come to lead us and guide us in all truth, is also the one who tells us about the things that are about to come to pass. He's telling me about something. He's trying to get you and me to respond to him. This communion table right here is response to him. Hallelujah. I'm going to do communion tonight. Start doing communion. I'll like to do it right now, but I just don't want to. I don't like communion to be afterthought. I like to be center thought. Hallelujah. Papa's looking for us to get in a place where we can be a place of connectivity with him, a place of obedience with him, a place of purpose with him, a consecration with him, so that which he's about to do, those things which he's doing now, and that which he's about to do, may be supplied to us, may flow right into our being. I want you to stand with me. Some of you may stand here today and feel like, well, I don't know how to change. I don't know what to do. I'm stuck in a rut. I keep opening that door that's going to fall off. I automatically go to open the door. The fact of it is, I don't have a lock on mine, so I just open it, coming in, going out. I kind of keep beating myself up going, when am I ever going to learn? Quit opening the same door. Go to the one that works. When am I ever going to learn to quit relying upon myself and start relying upon the Holy Ghost? When am I ever going to learn to quit praying my own prayers and get into a place of relationship with the Lord where God, the Holy Ghost, can begin to flow out of me? When am I going to learn that I can't connect with God till I connect with that which He supplied to the church to bring forth this perfection and this maturity? You're not going to grow. There's that maturity word. You're not going to grow unless you connect with God and with, connect with the things that God has supplied, the provision that He's given through His apostles, prophets, evangelists, pastors, teachers, to connect with the church, the people that are around you. Hallelujah. There's a great blessing in blessing those who are blessed by God, but there's also a blessing in blessing those who curse you. Hallelujah. When are we going to quit being our own men? When are we going to quit being our own women? When are we going to quit living by our own thoughts and by our own conclusions and by our own impressions and by our own decisions? When are we going to stop and start living by the Word of God? Because if you don't live by the Word of God, you're just going to wander around in a desert. Going from one problem to from bitter water to, you know, from bitter water to another desert spot, another wilderness spot, another about to die place. We rejoice with joy. We receive the end of our salvation when we rejoice with joy, unspeakable and full of glory. And though, if it's needed, though. Right now, many of you be in many type of afflictions and overwhelmed with all kinds of challenges and problems. That the trying of your faith, which is much more precious than gold, though it be tried by fire, may be found in the praise and honor and glory it is coming. The parousias of God is not just the one great event that's going to come in, on that great day, but the parousias of God is his continual visitations. I mean, in Wells, they used to set the clock by it. God would come and sovereign move of his presence. And a young man about 12 years old named Evan Roberts said, what do I got to do to be one of those great moves that have happened almost every 40 years in Wells? What do I got to do? And the pastor said, just be in church, be in the meeting, be hungry for God, cry out to him, let him know that you don't want to be left out, that you've got to be right in the big middle of it all. And Evan Roberts took it to heart, and God began to shake the world through him some 12 years later. September 28, 1904. I'm a man purposed in God for a great destiny in him. Who are you? I'm living every day. I live, I eat, I think, I sleep, I wake up in the night. Somebody said, oh, Mark, what happened to you? Somehow your mind was renewed. Somehow you stepped into that. No, you didn't understand. I find on my life, on my identity, you can have it too instantaneously. All you got to do is start living by the Word. Start thinking differently about yourself. I don't live for anything else. I'm not living for anything else. Yeah, I'm running wide open that I could be a part of seeing the unreached people groups that are on the earth right now be reached in so many different ways. And we're doing these things, the strategy that the Lord gave me to me. It doesn't matter. Maybe nobody even understands it. It doesn't even matter. You don't have to understand it for God to work a miracle through your life. Everybody gets it when it's going on. They write books about it later. Think about what they would have done if they were there. This is what happens. Every moving of God, every revivalist, everybody, come on. It's the way it works. It's the way it goes down. If you need everybody to understand what God wants to do through you, it ain't going to happen. But all of that pales and is nothing and is meaningless in view of what I expect God to do, what I'm living for. I'm living every day for the full revelation, the purpose, person of Jesus Christ to be made manifest in me. I want nothing else. What are you doing? And that ain't going to happen because I'm sitting around just hanging out. And that's going to happen because I passively lay hold upon God. Amen. I've been in the same church for 34 years. I don't need to go anyplace else. I'm taught of the Holy Ghost. I'm taught of God. You can be taught of God too. I don't need to be in a meeting where there's 30,000 people all screaming to be overwhelmed by the glory of God. I have that all by myself. I have it now. I feel the wind of His Spirit.
I feel the overwhelming glory of heaven. I feel His robes of righteousness. I feel His goodness that has brought the gift of holiness into my life. I feel this cloud of glory around me right now. I can actually touch it with my hand this very moment. Heaven's here. Heaven's there with you. Wherever you go, He said, I'll be with you. I'll never leave you nor forsake you. I'll be both in you and with you. When all of a sudden nothing becomes important to you, nothing else matters, but the glory of heaven being made manifest in your life, God's will being done, Jesus being revealed, His life being manifest. You listen to me. Hear me. Giving God the leftovers have got to come to an end. Giving God second best has got to come to an end. Having God just fit somewhere in your life has got to come to an end. Nobody ever at any time ever moved into these things that we're talking about that are witnesses to us since the days of Jesus who did not fully give themselves over to the Word of God, the Spirit of God. Do it today. Do it today. It today. Quit walking in the counsel of the ungodly. Some of you got parents. They don't know the Lord. Don't walk in their counsel. Love them, but don't walk in their counsel. You listen to me. Some of you have close friends that don't even know the Lord. Don't walk in their counsel. Walk not in the counsel of the ungodly. Do not stand in the way of sinners. Never sit in the seat of the scornful. Never be found reproaching someone or speaking bad of someone. Because it runs counter to this glory and this love that God wants to be made manifest through our lives. It's essential to connecting with Him and connecting with one another. It's giving your members over to darkness and the working of Satan.
It would stop that which God wants to reveal to your life. Just commit today. And I'm going to tell you right now. You'll step into divine healing. I walk in divine health. I live in divine health because it's available. Hallelujah. I don't get sick and haven't been sick for many years. I don't get sick. I walk in divine provision. Everything that I have need of, He provides what I have need of. Because I stepped over into a realm. You could step over in this realm. You don't have to have many examples. One example should be enough to do. Somebody said, well, I love God and I'm sick. Well, I'll tell you right now, you can love Him more and not be sick. Hallelujah. Praise God. Somebody said, well, you're messing with my relationship. No, I'm not trying to bring you up into a deeper one. Amen. We're happy for the relationship you've got with God. We just want you to realize the greater benefits of all that He has for you. Just receive right now. Just lift your hands towards heaven. Just receive right now. Just receive right now. That was just heaven's supply. God is supplying something to you. Hallelujah.
Hallelujah.
God is supplying something to you. Leslie Faulkner. God is supplying something to you. Hallelujah. 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 I tell you, proper response to God brings forth great faith. And great faith brings forth the proper response to God, no matter how trying the situation may be. And you listen to me. Set your heart on Christ Jesus and on pleasing Him. And Father will reveal the great faith through your life. Set your heart on pleasing Him. Set your heart on pleasing Him. Jesus, Jesus, Jesus. Thank you, Lord Jesus. People, listen to me. Honor those people that are around you that God's placed in your life. You may not understand who they are. You may not understand what God's purposed them to do. But what you can understand is that they have been placed in your life. Not by accident, but by God, and you want to honor that. because otherwise you're not making the connection. Somebody said, well, if I could just go find some place that I could honor somebody more, respect them more. You'll never find that place. Because the same power of darkness that stops you where you're at right now will stop you there. Yes. Has really nothing to do with anything other than the enemy running interference, trying to block that which Father God is supplying. Listen to me. Just listen to me. Listen to God. Listen to the Holy Ghost right now. Just listen to Him. Some of you are dealing with challenges. You're dealing with broken relationships. You're dealing with financial struggles. You're dealing with impossible situations. Got any mountains you can't tunnel through? Got any rivers you think are uncrossable? Got any mountains you can't tunnel through? God specializes. God's special, it's His specialty. He specializes in things thought impossible. He'll do for you what no other power can do. So it's one of the Latter Rain songs that I was taught by my mama. Got any rivers you think are uncrossable? Got any mountains you cannot tunnel through? God specializes in things thought impossible. He'll do for you right now what no other power can do. He'll do it now. He'll do it now. You can call it done, and it'll be such a reality to your soul. You can call it done. You won't need any outward evidence. You can call it done. You can call it done tonight, today, tonight, and live in the beauty and the splendor of it for the rest of your life. You can make today a day in which you sought God and found Him. You can make today a day in which you called unto the Lord and He answered you. You can make today a day of encounter that you'll never get over. Hallelujah. The encounters with God you never live a day without. Woo! I'm telling you. Hallelujah. The encounters I've had with God, I never live a day without them. They are living reality to me. Jesus. 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 Holy Ghost, do you work right now? Holy Ghost, do you work right now? Do you work upon every life in this place? Holy Ghost, reveal Jesus right now, we pray. I command every sickness and every disease and every torment and every failure and every fault and every condemnation and every lie to leave every person in this building, every person watching me right now by the web. I set you free right now in Jesus' name. I set you free. You go free. Free now to live by the word of God. Free now to walk in the Holy Ghost. Not free to do your own thing. Not free to do your own will. Free now to live under the power and reign of all God Almighty. Jesus. 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 Montamba rasateya pekina. Ora mamata seyani. Jesus, Jesus. Manny, you listen to me. You listen to me. You go free from the sickness and the disease. Listen to me. You have to understand, you make a choice of whether you live under the diagnosis of a doctor. You live under the word of men, and there is no cure. Or you come under the word of God. You come under the word of life.
Amen.
The word of the Holy Ghost.
Yes.
If you choose to do what Father says, and you choose to believe what He says, everything that He's described is yours.
Amen.
Everything that He's promised, you realize it.
You get, and many times we have to stand, and we're doing this, everybody in this place, to some measure or degree. You have to stand against all the opposition and all the other influences that demands of you to do something different or believe something different or go some other way. Or to behave in a way that's other than what God described for us to do. You and I decide. Man, come here. Just lift your hands towards heaven. Cancer is not a biochemical, biological response of a body that's not properly working, functioning. It's an afflicting, look at me, it's an afflicting demon power. All men in academia have done is identified certain behaviors and certain patterns and then try to call it based upon some ideology that writes God completely out of existence. And all the conclusions, by and large, it's wrong. You don't have to live under that authority anymore. Amen. You hear me now. In Jesus' name. From the crown of your head to the soles of your feet, I paint you with the blood of Jesus Christ. I set you free right now. You go free right now. So that no cancer returns into your body. Is there anyone else here that recently went to a doctor and you received a diagnosis that you have some kind of a disease? Is there anyone here like that? You recently received a diagnosis of some disease in your body. Anyone watching on the web right now, I'm telling you, you go free right now. Just come under the word of God right now. The anointing of the Holy Spirit. Father loves you so much. I tell you right now, the miracle of healing is nothing to be compared to the miracle of His indwelling. His indwelling is so far, so beyond all other things. Is there anyone here right now, you've never received the miracle of the indwelling of the living God, where God Himself has come to live and dwell inside of you? Is there anybody here, you doubt the indwelling of God? That God the Holy Ghost, that God Christ Jesus, that God the Father of all things has come to inhabit your life, and He's made you a living vessel, a temple in which He dwells? If there's anyone that doubts that, God wants to remove the doubt right now. He wants to work a miracle of salvation for you. If there's anything God's people need to see, receive right now at this time, and He's also be reminded of, is to receive the life of Christ, to begin to walk out the life of Jesus Christ, to begin to walk out the life of God, the very existence of the Almighty. If these things are lacking in your life, God's here to touch you right now, to make everything new. To bring a whole new reality into your life to where you can begin to walk it out word by word. Hallelujah. Day by day, event by event, step by step. And in that connection that God alone supplies to us. And that provision that God alone supplies to us. Grow and mature and increase with the increase of God. Hallelujah. Step into all His fullness and bateria. Just think about the reality. Let God stir in your faith that even at this moment in time, you could step into all the fullness. At this moment in time, you could begin to realize an overwhelming, manifest presence of God that redefines everything about relationship with Him. And it can happen now, right now. It doesn't have to wait till tonight. It doesn't have to be delayed to another day. That is a commitment and a consecration of your heart. God knows the hearts of all men. God who searches the hearts of all men searches now at this moment in time. The Lord whose eyes go to and fro throughout the earth looking for anyone looks right now towards you. Will you be the one? Will you be one of the many? Will you be one of the many that are the few that God's going to raise up in these last days? Mandere sitana nama, mambala mosekina haya,
Father's waiting to supply. If there's anyone here, you've never received the miracle of salvation, receive right now. If there's anyone here at this moment in time, you doubt as to whether or not God has come to make his dwelling on the inside of you. Have you not realized the indwelling of the Holy Ghost, the indwelling of the presence of Jesus? Right now is your opportunity. You can respond right now. You can come up here. We'll lay hands on you. We'll pray with you. Look, I'm telling you right now, there is a lost reality to the church. I believe that we have to go back to a place that our fathers had in God, where they prayed with people until change took place. Mass conversion wasn't a part of the equation. The quality of the transformation, praying till we prayed through, was what life was all about, church was all about. Laying hands on someone, praying with them till heaven filled their soul, till doubt was removed. We have to be committed to the things that has seemingly been lost to the church if we're going to have the same results that they had. Now, the Lord wants to begin to birth a reality in your spirit. It's more than a strong impression. It's a living reality. It's a revelation. It's more than a strong impression. Now, you have to let go of this afflicting, tormenting spirit. It constantly rule over your mind if you let it. Listen, disaster, the loss of a loved one, you know, divorce, broken relationship, just the loss of finances, financial crisis, those kinds of things that just, they can become a cancer of the mind. Okay, now here's what I'm going to, I understand. And don't think that I'm not being compassionate and understanding. I want to help you understand a different way. Listen to me. And everybody else can listen and understand this. There is a way to step out of the problem and step into the solution. There's a way to step out of the problem and step into the solution. Listen to me. It's a way to make all of the issues irrelevant. Look, all of the torment, all the crisis. You think about a financial. You think if you had a financial crisis, you're going to get kicked out of your house. You don't have any food to eat. You think about the pressure of that. You think about, you know, if all of a sudden you were up against a situation and you know, your life is being threatened. You think about the pressure, the demand that is placed upon you to only think about that, those issues, to be captivated, imprisoned by the problem. There is a way to make all of the problems and all of the issues completely irrelevant. Are you ready?
Yes.
I'm telling you, because I'm talking about faith. As long as all of the crisis and all the problems are relevant, you're going to be in a place called doubt and unbelief. But there is a way to step out of it, to make it irrelevant, to where that it's nothing even matters. All that you want of me, Father, is all I desire, and all that I desire is you. Can you hear me? Can you make your life irrelevant? Can you love not your own life even unto death? Can you make your own existence, your own values, your own purposes irrelevant? All that you've ever desired and all that you've ever wished within the framework of earthly desires, irrelevant. All the threats, all of those things, irrelevant. Bullets, irrelevant. Knives, irrelevant. Threats of men irrelevant, finances irrelevant, and all that is relevant to you is God your provider. Hallelujah. God your way maker, God your savior, God your healer. Hallelujah. God your perfecter, God your redeemer. Where all of a sudden your natural existence becomes irrelevant, your eternal existence is all that's relevant. The temporalness is irrelevant, the eternalness is all that's relevant. Your successes in a natural world are irrelevant. You're hearing, well done, my good and faithful servant, all that is relevant. Step over in faith right now. Just lift your hands towards heaven. See, this is humbling yourself under the mighty hand of God because he cares for you. It doesn't even matter anymore. It doesn't even matter anymore. Listen, these things have only power these things have over you is the power you give to it. Do you know that hurt makes you give it power? That's why you got to forgive. Fear makes you give these things power over you. Perfect love casts out the fear. Does anybody know how to make, does anybody here know how to be made perfect in love? Does anybody here want to know how to be made perfect in love? You ready? Simply knowing and believing the love that God has for you. Herein is our love made perfect. Hey, not my opinion. How do you like that? I didn't have to distill that one out through some kind of, you know, Greek word study and how it related to, you know, Septuagint Greek and then how it's then linked to Hebrew. Hallelujah. Praise God. Father, make this stuff so simple babies can understand. Are you listening to me? Hallelujah. You want to be made perfect in love? And you want perfect love's going to do? It's going to cast out the fear. And when fear's no, listen, when fear has no more power over you, you know what? You no longer live under the control influences of doubt and unbelief in the snare of the enemy.
The power of God comes on you right now. From the crown of your head, in Jesus' name, you foul spirit of hell, I break your power. In Jesus' name, I loose you now and set you free from every influence of the enemy. Go free. Free now to love God. Free now to serve God. Free to walk in his word. Free to walk in the spirit. Free no longer to be held in prison to all the stuff. All the problems and all the issues. And all the disappointments and all the discouragements. In the name of Jesus. Now you got, look, you're going to leave the former things behind. You're not going to take any of the former stuff with you. God wants to take you to a place you've never gone before. You know what happens? God wants to take people to a place that they've never gone before, and they want to return to what they were doing. No, God wants to take you to a place that you can't even begin to expect. You've never been there before. So right now in Jesus' name. Right now in Jesus' name. Right now in Jesus' name. You forgive. You gotta forgive. You gotta forgive. I mean, you gotta really forgive. You gotta forgive so much that when you see him, you're like in love with him. Uh-oh. You can't do that on your own, can you? So receive right now. Just receive. Forgive right now. Forgive it. Let it go. Yeah. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Lord Jesus. No, God wants a staporanaki, a bataya to come out of you. Come on. Come on. No, Father wants it to go deeper. Father wants to go deeper. He doesn't want you to return to former things. He wants to go into deeper things. And now, in Jesus' name. Now, in Jesus' name. Now, look at me. Now, in Jesus' name. Bosta keretest. Bokaras de brisa. Give Kleenex. Bosadest. Look at me. No more brokenness. No more pain. Look at me. No more pain. No more living in the former things. God's got so much. Hey, listen to me.
Oh, that is so much more than you've ever realized. Waiting for you. Just step into it. Just step in. Step in. Just step in. Just step in. Step in. Just step in. Yes, step on. Step in. Step in. You know what God the Holy Ghost does? He encourages. You know what the realms of the satanic, the prince of the power of the air does? Discourages. Why even go with discouragement for a moment? Why? Why? Why would you want to do that? I want you to lift your hands towards heaven in expectation that something's going to happen to you that's never happened to you before. I want you to lift your hands in expectation that you're going to have an encounter with the presence of the Lord that you never had before. And while you're standing there, why don't you just go ahead and surrender in a way that you've never surrendered before? Why don't you just go ahead and begin to believe God like you've never believed before? Say, I am thine, O Lord. Say that. I am thine, O Lord. I surrender all to you. I surrender all to you. Say, I am thine, O Lord. Oh, I am thine, O Lord. Take full control. Take full control of me. Lord, I yield to you. Lord, I yield to you. I yield myself to you. The only way that you will grow and increase is through the supply that only Jesus can give. Hear me. Say it one more time. The only way you can grow and increase is through the supply that only Jesus can give. And Jesus only can give the supply if you're willing to make the connection that he demands. And the connection that he demands is first and foremost, your connection with him. And out of that, your connection with every person in the body of Christ. Your consecration and commitment to loving him. And as John said in the second epistle, this is the love that we obey him and keep, do what he says, that we keep his commandments. This is the love that God's looking for, the kind of relationship love. If you love me, you will obey me. And that's the words of Jesus as recorded by John. The growth and the increase that Father has for your life isn't limited. It's all his fullness. It's not limited. It's not limited. It should be explosive on a scale that can't even be hardly measured on a day-to-day basis. It's not limited, for it's all of his fullness. God has a growth in the increase, and only he can supply it. He has a growth and an increase that only he can supply to you, that he wants to supply right now, not later, now. That you now live out and walk out. That you have to live out and walk out. It's not just a meeting of, the encounter. It's also living it out and walking it out by his word and by his spirit.
Amen.
One last moment. I'm going to wait one last moment of time here before we
leave out of here. And I don't know, maybe some of you will never return, because you will leave this world and step into the next one. You'll leave this dimension of things and step into the other dimension. And I want to make sure that everybody in this place knows that their name's written in the Lamb's Book of Life, that you're right with God, that you're ready to stand before Him and give an account for every deed that is done in your body, every part of your life. He is going to inspect every dimension of your spirit and your soul and your being. And you're ready for that inspection. You'll be found in Him without spot or blemish. Unblameable in holiness before God. Something that will instantaneously take place as you call upon the name of the Lord Jesus, and you allow Him to wash you in His blood, change you by His Spirit, a miracle of a new creation, brand new, kept by the power of God. And people, if there's something that's marred your life, because I feel that there's that going on right now in certain, whether there's people watching me by the web or there's people in here, things have marred your life. You allowed it to mar you, and you blame it on someone else. You allowed it to evilly affect you, and you blame it on someone else. Let God erase that right now. Let the Spirit of God erase that and remove it from off your life, that it cannot mar you anymore, that the flow of heaven is there. Because I'm looking at some faces right now that need the flow of heaven on it. I see you captivated in prison. You know you're captivated in prison by other things when the flow of heaven's just not there. The flow of heaven, the supply, the busting loose of the rivers. There will come a time in your life where you're not willing to live without that unction, that busting forth of the empowering inspiration, that which is not of you, it's of God, and it takes you and sweeps you away. You'll come to a place where you will not be willing to live without that. It is a glory of God's divine moving upon our lives. It's time to have it now. It's time to say goodbye to religion. It's time now to get hungry. It's time now to get thirsty. It's time now to recognize what God says and be willing to be conformed to it. It's time now. It's time now. He's searching. He's searching you. He searches out. He that searches all the hidden parts of the being searches you out right now to heal you, to fix you, to fill you. I'm going to make one last altar call. I'm going to tell you. You can either stay right where you're standing, you can receive right now, or if there's a stronghold, we'll pray for you. The stronghold will be broken. I do not have any problems. And you don't have to have any either. I don't have any problems because I don't make problems relevant in my life. I don't give problems any power. I have just as many things coming at me, and maybe even more than you have, but I give them no power. They had no power. They immediately disqualified. They immediately not allowed to work. They immediately dealt with by the Word of God and by the Spirit of God. Amen. Somebody said, "How you deal with it by the Word of God?" I quote the Word of God, the Scripture. I declare what God has done for me. How do I do it by the Spirit of God? I allow the Holy Spirit to pray through me and speak through me to deal with everything that is contrary to what God wants and wills. And you can do the same thing. Yes. Right now. Right now, the glory of heaven. Right now. Right now. Right now. If I asked you, everyone who's happy and contented with the moving of God in your life, to raise your hand right now, I would pray that not a single person would raise their hand in this building. And if that were truly the case, then everybody in here is hungry. And if that is truly the case, then God will come and fill every hungry heart and every thirsty soul. Just begin to let the holy emotions of heaven begin to stir your spirit. Just begin to let those holy emotions of heaven begin to stir in your spirit. Don't allow your emotions and don't allow your attitudes to be imprisoned by problems and by your struggles and by your doubts and by fears and by things that the enemy of your soul would impose upon you. Begin to let God the Holy Ghost begin to stir holy emotions in you. Let me be la bore de yashika. Take a drink and let the Spirit of the living God begin to flow out of you. Just take a drink and out of your belly shall flow rivers of living water. This is the key of the Holy Ghost. Just a drink. Just a little drink. Just a little drink of his presence. Ifrese. Ifrese. A God that cannot influence you more than the comedian is not a God at all. A God who cannot influence you more than earthly things is no God at all. God that cannot make you more happy than some earthly desire is no God at all. God is not bigger than your problems is no God at all. Today, let God be God. Today, be the first to step into the sovereign moving of his outpouring of his presence that captivates you, sweeps you away into a realm that you didn't even know existed. Today, lay hold on him. I pray in Jesus' name that you'll never live from this day forward in expecting that God's going to do the same thing he did last time. That you won't live anymore in these false expectations of just being willing to be content of having just as much as you have up to this point of all that God wants to supply when it's all his, every dimension of his fullness. But every day you begin to live in a passion for that increase.
Yes, 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 Lord.
Randy, I want you to come here. Just begin to see yourself living in the overshadowing of his presence. You know, there's a glorious divine imagination that's good. There's an imagination that belongs to this world and that is of earthly things and of human perceptions is bad, it's evil, it's full of every influence of the enemy. But there's imaginations that only God's word and God's call creates. Hallelujah. Seeing what the Word of God describes, in other words, as a living reality right now in your life. There's an overshadowing of the presence of the living God that He has for you. There's a fellowship and a communion that Father doesn't want you to live another day without. Where did Jenny go? Could close my eyes. Can you call her back?
I don't want anybody leaving here with your problems. People got wrong expectation. They think that somehow God's going to change. God's not changing. Somehow God is going to work over top of that which he demands you to change. He's not going to do it. God has called us out of darkness. He's given us the opportunity to agree with him. Jesus. Kirila, come here. The nation of Kirila, come here. The state of Kirila and the nation of India. This is your hands for heaven. Speak Hiroshiana Moshiach.
Manda estea. Manda estea. Manda estea. Manda estea. Mandestea, Mombrastiki. The Lord wants you to live in expectation of an explosion of his glory and his person and his presence through your life. Manda estea, este moritea. See, you didn't come here to go to school and to do all these things in business. You came here to receive power from on high, to be something totally different than exists right now among the Hindus and among those even Christian Hindus in India. But to begin to step over into the realms of the kingdom of God. Jesus, I break every influence of the culture off of you now. Dostina, dostina masabeya turamast. Dostina maya. Iktaste berona piki. Iksta parane ipishikosta. Epena este ikana moshikaya. The Lord has provided for you the same fellowship and the same relationship that he's provided for anyone who will hearken unto his voice and respond to his word. You don't have to live disappointed. You don't have to live distraught. You don't have to live in failure and without. For a flow of heaven is there for anybody, anywhere, no matter what situation they find themselves in. But the arm of flesh and the struggle of men will destroy that which God would do, will make nothing that which he's purposed to exist. But simple obedience and surrender to his word will suddenly work a miracle. Suddenly, the outpouring of God will be realized through your life. If you no longer live under the oppression of a lie, but rather be dominated by the truth. Wishing things different makes nothing change. Praising God for all that he's done brings out the reality of the life of his son. So just One small touch. Just one small touch. Just one small touch. Received in faith.
Yes.
Just one small touch. Received in expectation.
Yes.
Changes everything.
Yes.
Do you know what the Word of God does? For everyone who's willing, it prepares their heart to receive what God would give. The biggest challenge is breaking down the strongholds of those things that have been allowed to be the influence and the drivers in your life. Asta Koronea. See, there's a river that has healing streams. And that river, God would have its supply flow through you right now. There is a river with God's healing streams. Oh, stipinikiste. Mande rastikinaka. Mande stikinatakuto. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Lord Jesus. Thank you, Lord Jesus. Angelica, I want you and your mom to come here. Just lift your hands towards heaven. Listen, the Lord gives you the opportunity to live by His word. The price you have to pay is that no longer will you live by your opinion. See, in times like this, the Spirit of the Lord would come to visit you and give you strength and empower you. Yes. Simply so that you'll live by His word and not live by your opinion. Start saying, the glory of heaven fills my soul. Instead of, I wish that the glory of heaven would fill my soul. One is doubt, the other one's faith. One is agreement with God's word, the other one's living under the opinions of men and the oppression of the things that are around you. The glory of heaven fills my soul. Why do you think the Word of God says, forget not all of His benefits? Simply so that you can begin to now confess and speak out that which God is doing, agreeing with Him
results in a miracle. Agreeing with God results in a miracle. Just agreeing with God results in a miracle. Just agreeing with God results in a miracle. Agreeing with God results in a miracle. Agreement with God, the transfer 7, results in a miracle. It is time that people no longer sit and hear the word of God and yet not do it. It is time that people hear the word of God and receive the word of God in faith that's mixed with faith, and then they place a demand upon God and himself and begin to just do it, begin to have it, in an unwillingness to live without it. All the expressions of heaven. All the expressions of heaven. All the expressions of heaven. Come.
Say that. Stasta tanemeki. Bastini. Lepreston. 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 Now in Jesus' name, every power of mind and thought that would hinder you from that which God the Holy Ghost has supplied to you, it's broken right now. Everything that culture would impose upon you, religion would impose upon you, it's no more authority, no more influence.
Heaven's glory is yours right now. 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 It just takes a little bit of believing that to fully receive the impact of it. Just a little bit of believing that and you'll receive the full impact. You don't believe that, nothing will happen. Heaven's glory is yours right now. You say, but you don't understand. You don't know my problems. You don't know my shortcomings. You don't know my failures. Irrelevant. Heaven's glory is yours right now. Jesus doesn't come to you and say, well, let me just evaluate your failures and your shortcomings, your problems. I'll let you know whether or not you're a candidate for salvation or a candidate for my miracle or the supply of the things that I want to give. Say, heaven's glory is mine right now. Say, heaven's glory is mine right now.
Monday, a shade. Say, heaven's glory is mine right now. Woo! Have mine gay combo over sheet. Jess, come here. Jess says yes. Mãos desde tu está. Mãos deste. Flowing in the Holy Ghost. Walking in His anointing. Living out His divine purposes. Seeing yourself being everything that He described in His Word. Being the enemy of all doubt. Being the enemy of all unbelief. Having authority to rise up in that which God has spoken. Do it. Put your hands towards heaven. Heaven or hell is the choice of every man. Demon powers or the Holy Ghost, the choice of every man. The toys of the flesh or the riches of the spirit, it's the choice of every man. Living in pain, sickness, and disease, and trouble, or living in heaven, in the glory and the joy of all that He has brought, it's the choice of every man. Choose this day. Choose. Pasta carine. Pantas to be. Every foul spirit of darkness try to lay claims upon this life. I'll bind you and I'll break your claim and your power now in Jesus' name. Put the blood of Jesus upon you. The life of Jesus upon you. Have the security issue. Ah, brasique. We can choose if we desire to let sorrow and sadness dominate our life. Or we choose to let joy and rejoicing dominate our life. It's our choice. We choose to make the problem bigger than God or make God bigger than the problem. People are always trying to figure their way out of their issue. And then in that you shut down the miracle of heaven. Just this day, turn yourself over to God. Just this day, turn yourself over to God and let Him begin to be the Lord of your life. Let Him begin to be the master of your spirit, of your soul, of your emotions. This day, turn yourself over and watch God work. This day, stop holding part back for you and turn yourself completely over to Him. This day, the choice is yours. You make it. God won't make it for you. You make it. This choice is yours this day.
You make it. You live in the joy, and you live in the rejoicing, and you live in the miracle, and you live in the authority, and you live in the glory, and you live in that place committed and consecrated to that which heaven is supplying. Then you'll have easily those things which God has provided. That ability that He has given. Amen.
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 And God, the Holy Ghost, is going to make that stronger. The response is going to become stronger. The response is going to become more bold. The response is going to become more powerful. Response is going to become more receptive. The expectation greater. The oneness more expressed. We're always wanting God to do the things that He's described, but on the basis of the way that we want Him to do it. He's going to do nothing that He's described until we're willing to submit to His plan and to His will. Monday's about you being proven, even between the services. Because the enemy's going to come and try to shut down and stop anything that consecration and commitment in your life would open the door to Christ Jesus to now have a greater influence. Monday's about a proving time. Tuesday's about a proving time. Father's looking for some people who will, no matter what they go through, no matter what things they face, they will be found in Him. Doing it His way, the way He described. Not sitting with their lips. Not choosing the wrong response. But continually being filled with the Spirit. And see, when you know that this is the issue, that this is the point of the battle, if you would, and the examination, you'll recognize your need to be continually filled with the Spirit, continually filled with the Holy Ghost. You'll begin to be recognizing your need to continually pray with all prayer and supplication in the Holy Ghost. Then you'll begin to recognize your desperate need to be continually built up in your most holy faith, praying in the Holy Ghost. Because you'll recognize that without Him, you'll fail. Without Him, you'll just go right back over into the other problem, the issue. You'll be stuck and spend your whole life being a baby in Christ. Babe. At best. Let's let God begin to do what He wants to do through our life and in our life. Let's let Him overwhelm us like He described. Where His glory comes on us like a fire, and His presence in His work outworking flows through us like rivers gushing out of us, out of our emotions, out of our passions. Where we begin, because so many people get stuck in religion and they try to pray and they try, to have a moving of the Spirit in their life and they try to praise, and it's just them. They've never come under the divine unction where it's gushing forth and it's not you anymore. It's something beyond you. And then you have that encounter, which I'm sure every person in this place has had that encounter. But then it becomes more than an encounter. It becomes a dwelling place where you're unwilling to live without that overwhelming display of the power of God, where He does it through you. And nothing to do with you. It's just Him doing it through you. Whew. And the praise and the joy and the flow of heaven's glory begins to dominate every dimension of your emotions and your passions. And you don't go to prayer anymore, you call to prayer. And you don't have a handle on a pump trying to prime it. You've got a continuous flow. That's called the moving of God in your life. And if you're willing to live without moving of God, you're willing to live without revival and the ongoing of revival, it's your choice. It's not, but Father's chosen something so much more beautiful for you, so much more wonderful for you. Just receive it. Begin to walk in it. Become extremely upset if it's not happening. And passionate if that flow is not taking place. Begin to lift up your voice and cry out to Him, letting Him know that you cannot possibly live without that overflow of His glory in your life. Begin to tell Him those things that you know He wants to hear from you about your consecration, your surrender, your desperate need for Him, and the Holy Ghost flow again, whatever it is that's going on in that time, and watch what God will do. You'll live in a continual flow of His glory. Amen.
Amen.
But an ever-increasing flow. Not the same flow. Say, I don't think people get this, so I've got to have you repeat after me. Say, not the same flow.
Not the same flow.
An ever-increasing flow.
Ever-increasing flow.
Not the same manifestation.
Not the same manifestation.
A greater manifestation.
A greater manifestation.
The increase.
The increase.
The growth.
The growth.
The full maturity. Yeah.
Just get desperate with God and begin to talk to Him like that. Watch what happens. Amen.
Amen.
Praise the name of Jesus. Well, I don't want to stop, and I'm not going to stop. I will continue on even though I leave. I'm going to stay right in the realms of the Holy Ghost. Between now and the time I come back to the meeting, you'll see I didn't miss a beat. You'll see I come right back in here, flowing in the Holy Ghost. I'm not even slowed down a little bit. I live in the move of God. I live in the move of God. I don't go from move to move. I live in the move of God. I live in the overshadowing. I live in the great outpouring. I live in the revival. Hallelujah. I live in the outworking of the Spirit of the living God, and He's inviting you to live there too. We want you to have enough of a move of God so you don't lose it in the next hour. Amen.
Yeah.
Or even in the next day or in the next week.
Yeah.
I'll tell you, I've been in places where the great moves of God, but I mean, if you go find the people that were in the building and you go see them the next day, it's like, what? What are you doing now? What happened? No, you need to follow on. That moving of God needs to work within your life of consecration to serve Him. Amen.
Amen.
So before you leave, we want you to participate with the miracle that God has for you in the realms of honoring Him and worshiping Him with your substance. Honoring Him and worshiping Him with the supply of the things He's given you. Honoring Him and worshiping Him with your tithes and with the offerings and with all the first fruits of your increase. Because He's going to cause you to abound more and more, and He'll cause all grace to abound in you. Hallelujah. To where that you'll have all sufficiency. That word I read to you, where it says abounding in love one towards another, more and more, the Greek word is to have more than enough. It is truly the only biblical word. There's one in Exodus 16:16, like it. To be supplied with more than enough. That means, and so we translate it abound. Hallelujah. Hallelujah.
Somebody said, how are you doing? If I had nothing in my bank account, and I was in the minus red, and everybody was had sent me bills, I'd be saying I'm abounding and more than enough. That's why I don't have that problem, because I live and I don't care. I don't live by the dictates of my environment and those things which are reported around me by men and by demons. I live under the word of God. Hallelujah. If I was sick and diseased and somebody said, how are you doing? I'd say, ha, I'm living in health and divine blessings and under the glory of the Lord who heals me. Hallelujah. Come on.
Amen.
When are you going to start believing what God says on the basis of the way he said it and the way he did it? Amen.
Amen.
Do that. Follow me. I'm blessed. Do you think I'm blessed? Well, then follow me as I follow Jesus. Let's follow the Holy Ghost.
Amen.
So worship the Lord with giving. Some of you probably already did it. I can't hardly see what's going on. And now find a bunch of people. Start with the people that you don't like that much. Okay, if you don't have that person, go to the person that you don't live with first. Because your hugs ought to have been done with the people that's in your house. Well, I mean, they would already been done today.
Okay.
You can come back to it and do it some more.
Okay.
Go hug the person you don't know. Go hug the person you never hugged before. Tell them that you love them. Bless them in Jesus' name. And watch what God will do. He'll begin to open up your heart to people all around you so that his work and supply can flow through you to them.
Receive his supply so you'll have one to give.